Just white water around.
5 minutes. 5 minutes. I'm going to eat, and in 5 minutes.
So I can go that way instead of under here.
You know, Dave, if you want to talk a little bit while I'm eating, come on up.
We had a bet.
Oh, like, Dave's going to go anywhere, and I'm not going to let him talk. Seriously.
I was hoping to be anonymous today.
All right, let me go ahead and start it. Good morning, Breakfast Clubbers!
Morning. Morning!
All right, we're going to give you preview into what's going to be happening over the next year. That's why you see these pens and these pieces of paper. This is for predictions. All week on the radio show, I've been doing predictions, and, you know, everybody gets in. Davi and I did. Tim Petroche done. Frank, the guests all week. Everybody gets to have, like, a little prediction. So at the end of 2017, what will have or not have happened? I mean, it goes from Bill Clinton's going to be dead to, you know, whatever, you know. So, I mean, and these death predictions, I'm not a big fan of that, okay? That's not a good idea, you know. But the only reason that one was relevant was because there was an FBI agent that made a bunch of predictions about the Podesta emails and so on. And in there, also for legitimacy, we'll see what happens, that he thinks Bill Clinton is ill with cancer, or so he's not going to make it till the end of the year. So, anything else I'm open to, and go ahead and write down what you want. They're going on to an article on Freedom's Phoenix, Future Predictions 2017, Freedom's Phoenix, and I'll put it in the category of Breakfast Club or something like that.
What's the deadline?
Today. It was yesterday. It was yesterday, Michael, yesterday. And so for you guys at the Breakfast Club today, so you don't get to go past today, no. So what we're going to do is I'm going to have a presentation of why we had the Rick Falcon wing. It's Falconer, whatever how you say it in Swedish, but he was on the show for 2 hours, a little more than 2 hours.
There you go.
He was the one that created the Pirate Party out of Sweden, Germany, Austria. And it kind of took over, and they took over 16% of parliament in Iceland. And they're still right now. They couldn't, the other two parties couldn't form a government the way they do the parliament, you know, and the leader of their prime minister or whatever. They couldn't do it, so they gave it to the Pirate Party to create the coalition. They're in the middle of that now. So it's very interesting how this started, what's going to happen here in Arizona and around the country. Davi's working on a lot of concepts and the verbiage and the pirate code and, you know, kind of what the cool, fun volunteerists having some fun with it and set a standard. We have Scott Beezer doing a lot of the art. Now, what I did is 6 packets here, kind of show the progression, I'll explain, of the artwork and different things that we're doing. We had the ArizonaPirateParty.com, but it's not a party political, it's a party, okay? So there'll be some political aspects of it, but that's not the focus, and I'll explain why. It's kind of like, you know, the Lovolution and so on. Now, Dr. Frank was supposed to come, and he may give us a Trump update and some stuff we've been talking about, the different appointments and what's going to happen, but they're going to try and make sure his inauguration is not fun, you know, so we'll see what happens. January 20th, the day of the inauguration, that evening, that Friday, we're having a party here. We're going to, you know, get the fires all going and everything, we'll have this party. One of the big reasons is, in addition to the inauguration, whatever entertainment that'll bring, we'll have TVs out and so on, news coverage and such, but it's also the 10th anniversary of the Ron Paul meetup, the first one this whole thing started. Yay. So that, you know, had Ned Vallejo, man, he's heavily involved in that, and it's a good idea, and we're going to have a 10-year, and then what do we do on the 10-year? Here we go. We start the next wave of the activism and having some fun. Now, there's, for predictions of 2017 that scare the living crap out of you and make you, you know, worried, and then you'll come over and be a pirate because Arizona Pirate Party. Okay. Dave Hodges, he's going to entertain us with his doom and gloom visions of. Yes? No? Yes?
Maybe.
No. Dave Hodges.
Hey, Dave.
Hey, everybody. Good to be back here. I'm still waiting for the sun. I feel like I'm living back in Colorado. 3 layers of clothing on. And happy to say it actually fits. Anyway, I was on Ernie's show yesterday, and we did talk a little bit about predictions, but there's something that's happened since I was on his show in terms of what I've come across. And I backtracked to the wee hours of the morning talking to some trusted sources. And I got an article up on the website. You might want to check it out when you get home. There's some other people that have pieces of this, but when you grab this piece and that piece and the other piece, you know, we've all known that Obama's trying to start World War III. That's no secret. And I just real quickly here, sent in 4,000 troops to the border from Fort Carson. We heard about that the day it happened because we had a source on the base.
Border of what?
Border of Russia. And then, of course, I believe it's a CIA MO that Russian ambassador, I mean, that was a CIA hit designed to drive a wedge between Turkey and Russia. And then the takedown of the jet from Russia with their top media on it, you know, the hackers, so to speak. And then you keep going on with these provocations, deportation of 35 Russian diplomats. For what? Where was the proof for this hacking exactly? And, of course, we never talk about the fact that George Soros had 16 voting states lined up with his voting machines, and Arizona was one of them. And, of course, you know, Channel 3 ran this story that when they turned on the voting machines, they all defaulted to Clinton, every one of them. And it was on Channel 3. I almost fell out of my chair when I saw the report, so I thought that wasn't supposed to be in the mainstream media. So you look at all the provocations, but here's what the latest is. It's not just 4,000 troops from Fort Carson and their support personnel, which would be about 20,000, because you usually have about a 5-to-1 ratio of support to combat troops. NATO is totally mobilized. According to Russia Today and Sputnik, the Russians have moved in mobile tactical nuclear weapons into the same area. And, you know, in history, it really reminds me of how the Mexican War got started. You had the border dispute, Nueces River, the border, or is it the Rio Grande? And General Taylor marches his troops towards the Mexican encampment, gets fired on, 7 Americans killed, and that was the provocation for war. I think we're in a very similar position. And what's interesting is Ben Hodges, no relation, who's the theater commander in Europe, said I forget the news source now, but it's in my article. He said, well, we've got to do this because the Russians overran Crimea illegally. They're provoking Ukraine. And he's not even on the same page with Obama. He's saying this is all because of the hacking. So his theater commander is an Obama. Not even on the same page with this nonsense. But he said everything will be consolidated by, and this is where the drum roll happens, January 20th.
Oh, God.
Inauguration Day. Now, this is what I spent a good portion of my night, you know, before talking to Fred, gentleman I came with today, and after, is I called military people I know. And I'm a student of military history, and I'm thinking, Putin is a damn fool if he lets NATO consolidate forces completely on his border. He's begging for trouble. It's like, if you know you're going to have to get in a fight with a guy, you don't let him raise his hands. You pop him before his hands come up. And this is what I think Putin is being forced into. It won't be January 20th when hostilities break out. If Putin decides that he can't wait for Trump to get inaugurated, the threat is too dire, it's too real, they're too compromised, he'll move right away. And it's real clear from what you read in the Russian publications that are online with their English translations, they're going to go nuclear as a first option. Now, I didn't say intercontinental. I mean, what I'm seeing right now is more tactical theater nuclear weapons. But this is a very, very serious situation. We would have talked about this yesterday if I'd had all these facts. But like I said, there's a fact here, there's a fact there. And when you put them all on paper, and I just lined them up one right after the other, it was like I had a holy crap moment and said, this is really, really serious. The other thing that's going to dominate our news, if we get through this war mode pre-inauguration, is what Trump is going to be facing out of California. How many of you are familiar but following what Paul Preston and I have been covering on the Cal Exit Movement? Yeah, this is a bad, bad deal. Ernie and I had a little mini debate on the radio yesterday. I enjoyed the heck out of that yesterday, Ernie. That was a good interview. But there are a lot of people, including John Rappaport, who I really respect, who said, just let California go, it's a piece of garbage, this and that, and self-determination. But see, it's not self-determination when a minority of the people who are thugs are making decisions for the majority of the people. That's not self-determination, that's tyranny. And that's what's going on in California. And what we know, because Paul Preston has people on the inside, and people in state government aren't totally on board with this. Let me explain what CalExit is. Jerry Brown wants to become El Presidente of the Republic of California. They have officially, and you go to my website, you can see the picture with the press release, California has opened an embassy in Moscow. So Putin is obviously talking peace on one hand with Trump, and he's hedging his bet by lining up with subverting the United States economically and national security. But Governor Brown is in league with George Soros and the Bank of China. Those are the major funding mechanisms. He also is in league with many of the top legislators in the California State Senate and their House who are pushing this like crazy. And they now, this is going to come out next week. And I know I'm not being videotaped. Am I being videotaped? I got to be careful because I've got some proprietary information I'm not supposed to release. Let's just say this. The people in Governor Brown's office have engaged in the willful destruction of public documents related to this issue. They have burned them, and they have also obstructed justice with FOIA requests, a lawsuit that's pending on these issues. And what we're looking at in terms of Governor Brown's allies, George Soros is involved, of course, and why wouldn't he be? He's involved in everything else negative. And then you've got the Mexican drug cartels. And according to the embedded sources that are in these meetings, the Obama administration's in attendance. And in one of the meetings in particular, and I had a discussion with one of the people who was in the meeting, and obviously we can't reveal identities because you're talking drug cartels, that's how you get the horse's head on your porch, and pretty soon it'll be your head. And oh, by the way, the opponents to this movement are the people that are trying to form the state of Jefferson to be the 51st state. The horse's head has reared its ugly head. These officials are getting decapitated rabbits put on their porches, and it's happened a lot. And it's going to come out. There's BabyReagan.com ran a story yesterday that just introduced the ideas. But I know where this is going, and they're going to be covering this in a great deal of depth. And we've got drug cartel members who have sat in these meetings and said, well, if they won't let us out, we will just start killing white people and cause so much chaos that they'll force us to get out. And the Obama administration, three representatives are there. Not a word was said, according to our witnesses. And they just took it in like, yeah, this is the course of action we're following. Now, Eric Holder has been appointed to be a spokesperson for California against the Trump administration. Well, by default, that makes him the spokesperson for CalExit, because this is clearly where some of their leadership is going with this. And then what came to me yesterday after I was on Ernie's show, I was told by someone who used to be in the DNC, this is not just Eric Holder. They believe Valerie Jarrett is joining forces. Janet Napolitano is definitely on board because she knows she's running the California University system, and she's on board with all this. This is a real serious threat. Now, if from my I absolutely detest California and how it's being run, and part of me says, yeah, let them go. But here are the real problems for us and the rest of the 49. National security issue. You got military bases that are vital to national defense. What are we going to do with that? Also, you've got coastline defense, and if California leaves, and with Mexico pivoting towards China because of their gas crisis, does California become a beachhead for a possible invasion of the United States? And you have to look long term. Folks, that didn't come from me. A former RSOF general told me that 5 days ago. He said, that's my major concern. And then you look at the fact that California produces so much agriculture that's consumed by the United States. So then you couple that with 15% of the farmers left the business in 2016. You're looking at major food issues, particularly with pricing and in spot shortages. And this is when you start reading the projections about what could come if California leaves and they try to uncouple their economy with the rest of the country. This will have devastating effects for the rest of our states, at least from an economic standpoint. So although, you know, Ernie and I talked about self-determination, let California do what they want, if the people of California felt this way, that's one matter. But you've got a bunch of thugs and tyrants, George Soros, Bank of China, okay, you look at these people, the La Familia, the Sinaloas, I mean, these are thugs, these are criminals. Yep. They're in league with a rogue governor who's already served his two terms. He's violating their state constitution by serving a third term. He does not belong there, yet he was able to get a judge to say, well, we have an exception rule here. I read it. I still don't get it. So they don't represent the people of California. I've covered this a lot on my YouTube channel. And I get people that write into me from California, and I'm getting very little resistance. When I blast this, it's at like 99%. This is bad. I'm from California. I'm not part of this. I got my gun, lock and load. I mean, this is going to reach a fever pitch, but it hasn't hit the public in a big way yet. I'll give you an example. My wife's cousin, well-educated psychiatrist, her husband, successful in business. They're bright people. They're intelligent about the world. They knew very little about CalExit when we visited them over Thanksgiving. And I gave them the A to Z, and their faces turned white as a ghost. They said, I had never dreamed it went this far. Because, see, the movement came out of Yes, California. And everyone said, well, that's a pipe dream, not going to go anywhere. It's leveraged to make pot legal, and this was some of the things you heard. But now it's gone way beyond this. My biggest concern from where I sit is the national security concern. You see, California's not alone in terms of possibly leaving the country. I don't know if you followed this or not, but Trudeau, that wonderful socialist up north, he sent 150 maple trees to the capitals of Oregon and Washington State. He's starting a movement called Cascadia. This was reported in the Seattle Times, and they're trying to get Oregon and Washington to become their own Canadian province. So we could look at the West Coast being gone. I mean, do I really need to explain the military strategic disadvantages to this happening? This is devastating. And then you pile the economic part on top of this. So, and at one time, someone wrote to me, and they were right in saying this. They wrote to my website yesterday and said, well, one time you were saying that if Texas seceded from the Union, you thought that might be a good thing. Yeah, that's when Obama was in charge, and it looked like Clinton was taking over. I would have probably seceded my house from the Union had Clinton got elected. But things have changed now. And I'm wondering, really, on Trump, there's two schools of thought. And I have to tell you, I'm on the fence. Time will tell. He's talking to Soros. He's talking to Kissinger. Okay? He may as well sit down with Adolf Hitler. Mm-hmm. Okay? And I don't like a lot of his appointments. It came out of Goldman Sachs. Mm-hmm. We've been there, down that road. We know how devastating that is. I want my bailout money back. So he should not be cohorting with these people. Some of his appointments I like. We need a General Patton if we're this close to war. Mattis is a great choice. He has all the couth of a bull in a china closet, but the man knows how to fight and he knows how to win. And he strikes fear in the hearts of our enemies. So that was a good choice. But Trump, a lot of people are looking at him now and thinking he's a closet globalist. Some people think he's trying to build a coalition of both sides. And I think that's possible. That was my initial reaction with some of these appointments. But is Trump going to do the hard things and what needs to be done? And let me talk about Congress's first week. Congress knows what's coming. Now, we all know there are a bunch of whores that are on the take. They all take their little campaign donations from the globalist corporations. They get the free trade agreements that have stolen tens of millions of jobs from this country and bankrupted millions of Americans. Congress isn't looking at that, as I predicted. Obamacare is up for discussion, but illegal immigration is not. And we need immigration. I say the position of my organization is that we need immigration because we have a 1.8 birth rate. We need to get to 2.1 to maintain these social programs if we're going to maintain them. And believe me, I'm not a fan of Social Security, not a fan of Medicare or Medicaid. They're run by a bunch of criminals, and they're inefficient. But do we really want to cut off the elderly in this country without some kind of transition program that's better? And without immigration, we can't maintain these programs or even come close to it. But do we really want ISIS walking across our border with the people who basically want to come here and do nothing but work and raise their families in a better environment? So I have no problem with the immigrants coming here. And most of them are told by corporation pamphlets in their host countries that, hey, come here. The government doesn't care. They might talk to you a little bit, but you're going to get to stay, and there's all kinds of free stuff. And so in their mind, they're not breaking any laws. I reject the idea they're criminals just because they're here, but I don't like the idea that we just have a willy-nilly come across the border with no security checks. That is suicide. When you have James Comey, who you can trust about as far as you can throw him, stand up on July 4th and say, we have terrorist cells of ISIS in all 50 states, maybe we should be paying attention. Well, Congress isn't even looking at the issue of immigration. And all that some of us are saying, can't we just validate who's coming in to make sure they're not tied to the Muslim Brotherhood, ISIS, Al-Qaeda, and not talking about discriminating against people who just want to come here, like my father's side of the family came here just to have a better way of life. So Congress and Trump, if Trump is going to pursue his agenda, there's going to be gridlock. And it's going to be up to the people to unlock that gridlock. How do you do it? You got to take a stand on a couple of issues is what I believe. Number one, campaign contributions from corporations need to become a felony. I mean, an absolute felony. Why? Because we're not giving money to Congress, so who the hell are they going to listen to? And the major reforms Trump has promised will never happen if they go against corporate interests until we change that fact. How do we get it to change? Well, we got to make it clear to our congressional representatives that unless you change it, you're not going to be back in 2018. And that's the power resides with the people. People think Trump got elected, we can sit down, go back to sleep, can stop prepping. Those people are fools. But I'm seeing a lot of it. Believe me, I'm seeing an awful lot of that. And we need to become more active than we've ever been before. And not just politically, because I still believe, as I've been advocating during the Obama administration, we should be not fraternizing with the enemy. That means don't go to Walmart, Kmart, and the other slave marts. Don't support these corporations who steal our jobs. Don't support these corporations who have tax benefits that you and I don't. And we need to go to mom and pop stores, need to eat in your local restaurants that are privately owned, and we need to get out of the system. See, Bitcoin's part of that same philosophy. We need to look at alternative economic means to conduct our business. And I don't care who the president is. I don't care if it's Trump. Because if you want to hasten the downfall of corporate control over America, it's up to us to do it at the grassroots level. It's not having the right president. It's not having the right political decisions. It's us collectively making decisions on where we spend our money. And final prediction. I don't see how we get out of 2017 if Trump is sincere about his agenda. I don't see how we get out of 2017 without major civil unrest that will at one point grow into a civil war. Now, Calexit, I think, will be the flashpoint. Will Trump be forced to send the troops in to arrest Brown and stop this treasonous sedition movement? That could be the flashpoint. Now, Calexit's supposed to come online and be its own country in 2019. But I do think we're going to see major civil unrest this year. Some of it will be Black Lives Matter inspired. It'll be artificial, but some of it's going to be genuine. It's going to be class warfare. And it could grow into a civil war if we don't have a strong president and the people aren't united behind these changes that we were promised. Well, anyway, it's always good to be out among you. I really wasn't prepared to talk today, but I just feel a whole lot better now. I got a lot off my chest. Thanks, sir.
David's been a good friend, you know, for Freedom Phoenix since the beginning, and we've worked together on a lot of different things, and of course his mindset towards things different than mine, but doesn't mean that we don't respect each other's opinion. A lot of times they overlap, and that's what he talked about, where the power of what we do, where our power is going to come from, is exactly what he is saying, is individual anarchist decisions, you know, because we are anarchist, voluntarist individuals from the time that we wake up until we go be slaves or something. The reason I say that is, when I wake up, there isn't a government that tells me what time to put on my alarm clock. There isn't a government in my refrigerator telling me what I do eat. There isn't a government that tells me what kind of car I buy. Well, that's not entirely true. Because the social and economic engineering done by collective government does determine a lot of these things. They influence what you do. It's all at a much more fundamental, way back when you're even kids level. The fact that my generation, a lot of yours, you grew up, you got up at a certain time, everybody was in rush hour traffic, everybody went to work for certain hours a day, it was usually daytime, that's all changing. Everything that we do, whether we telecommute, you live on the road, you're in your RV, you travel your winter visitor down here. A lot of you know, you winter here, you summer in northern climbing. The lives have changed. And any influence you can have on where you spend your money, what time you do your alarm clock, when you go on the freeways, whether you even use a freeway. These are things that we can influence because we're being influenced upon constantly, being it propaganda, being it who's going to be making different policy, what issues, what brand, what everything. So that's where I've always kind of focused my efforts was on culture, just people making individual decisions. How can we have that influence? You know, what is it that they want, you know, Calexit or not Calexit, Trump or Hillary, Republican or Democrat, you know, there's always this bicameral thing, you know, it's yes or no, it's black or white, and I'm going, you know, do I even have to choose? So my thing is, I raise my hand up real high, and it's the Israel thing, or it's a Calex thing, or it's something, I go, am I allowed not to care? Am I allowed to spend all my waking moments watching Flintstone cartoons? Okay? I mean, can I do something else? Am I allowed? No. Now, this is Scott Horton, anti-war radio. He'll come on. Nope. You got to care. And I go, the only thing I care about is the guy that's got the gun to my head taking my money to do all this stuff that you're talking about. That's the bad guy. Whoever's doing this. And you know what? It ain't no Muslim somewhere. So it's like Muhammad Ali going, hey man, no Vietnamese ever called me the N-word. You know what I mean? So I'm just like, hey, I'm not even comfortable saying it. A cultural thing. It's not because they say do, don't. I grew up in the South. I know how that was used, what it meant. It had more impact on the people saying it than who you'd say it to. You know? So I understand. Now this is what I'm going to do. Tommy, would you help me, please? Okay, there's 1, 2, 3, 4. Each table, give out one of these packets. Now, what this is you're going to, in order, on the front, this is designed like we've done our covers for our magazines, the artwork for our magazines. This is a horizontal, the masthead that goes on top of the webpage, ArizonaPirateParty.com. Okay. Now, you'll see it's an airship. Now, that's just the beginning concept. Now, you'll go in the other pages and you'll see more development of the ship and how the ship's almost being done. We're starting to get into the coloring, the artwork, the logos are coming. I mean, there's a lot more coming. Now, the thing is that that lake is Canyon Lake here in Arizona. Okay. Opens up kind of the ocean thing. The Pirate Cove, where you have the people living in the hills, and they got there, and at the top right of the page, you'll see the Freedom's Phoenix fighter. Okay, we have a bird of one of our covers of one of our magazines. We had the Freedom Phoenix bird. Now, the reason this is important is I want to have a place that we come and we interact, and we're having the pirate town, Tortuga in the Caribbean, whatever kind of place, but it's the ship. The whole concept was the promotion of airships. Airships are coming. Within the next, they're already started. They're being built. There are great plans for big airships that you live in, that you carry your yacht. You just lower it down to the ground. You got what they call a halo that has all your speed boats and your scuba gear and goes down, or you go to an event and you land and so on. Now, these Lockheed has one already now that they're doing, you know, for military tests and whatever. Now, these lifting bodies, they have these big round cushions. They'd be, you know, like 20 feet around that you have these hovercraft that you blow and it kind of scoots around on the water or the ground and take off or what. But it also, when it lands, it reverses thrust and sucks you down. So that's why you see on the wingtips, you know, when you look at these things, when it comes down, it gets down, down to the land and sucks down. It's cargo. This is Serenity. This is Firefly. This is how we do make our living is we just travel and ship your crap everywhere. Okay? We're pirates. We're merchants. This is a galleon. This is a galleon class of how we're going out. Now, we're going to Davi's going to give you a little bit of history on where pirates come from, the difference between a pirate and a privateer, letters of mark, and reprisal, you know, the whole concept and the culture of the pirate meme. Now, this is something that I was paying attention to because we're kind of pirates. We're just kind of, now, what 4409 did, he was confronting pirates. Well, he would equate that, you know, the state were pirates. Well, were they? No, they were privateers. And we'll explain the definitions of this. Now, what Davi is doing is working on a glossary of terms, and he'll tell you what's going on at the Renaissance Festival and how we're dealing with the rave community, like we were at Jackalope, how we deal with the Rennies, they call them, is these Renaissance festivals that go around the country and the world. You know, how we're dealing with a lot of different prepper communities. But this is going to go into everything. The founder of the Pirate Party in Europe, he was, you know, one of these tech geeks, had his own company making gazillions of dollars when he was 16. He's one of these online entrepreneurs. And he could see what was happening. He created the Pirate Party, and they started taking over by storm. It was freaking out Europe. Went to Iceland just this last, this fall. They had elections in Iceland, and the Pirate Party took 16% of Parliament. They went, what the hell just happened? Well, I knew it's, here it comes, it's coming. So what I did is right when Iceland did that, this was like October or something, September, October, I went ahead and got ArizonaPirateParty.com. I also got ArizonaPirateParty.com and some dots and everything else. Now, there already is USA Pirate Party. There is an Arizona Pirate Party Facebook. I don't care. That's, you know, pace. Good. We need a bunch of this stuff being done. But we have the newspaper, the website, the radio show. I have built up a bunch of on-air advertising. Free Talk Live is on 160 stations. I have been paying in and building up for months, getting a big, giant, you know, I'm going to do a bunch of advertising. But I knew I needed time to get this ready. We're going to launch it and turn on the web page and get everything all done. Now, you can go to the web page and you can see, you know, what we're kind of doing, but it doesn't really have the full effect on January 20th. Because January 20th, inauguration, they're going to be doing all their, oh, and we're not going to let them have a peaceful transition. Yes, I am. And my executive orders that we just erased all the bomb and this and kind of war and nukes going and all that kind of, we're going, ah, more reason for pirates, okay? So that is also the 10th anniversary of the creation of the Ron Paul first meetup, which was here in Arizona. Now keep in mind, Ron only announced at January 15, I mean, it was like 15th or something like that in 07. I mean, immediately, we're like, here we freaking go. So by end of February, we were already making signs at our headquarters that we were distributing around the country. When that took off, a lot of people didn't understand the Lovolution. It's a Lovolution, a revolution, peaceful, love, going to have some fun, voluntarist. Ron Paul is a great vehicle for that. I had Ron on the show just a couple weeks ago, and he's like, yeah, he was excited about his Liberty Report, the YouTube channel that he has. 60,000 subscribers, and we're doing, yeah, and the Lovolution, Ernie, we got to keep going, Revolution, Lovolution. I go, yeah, Revolution's always going to be, we're going to do this pirate thing. You know, it's kind of the, you know, yeah, but, and I can tell what's happening. We're doing exactly what, this is where Dave and I kind of diverge a little bit. I'm glad Dave's there. I'm I'm glad the Trump thing's going on. I'm glad Ron Paul's there. GM Griffin. We're going to, you know, get to the promise of the Declaration, Constitution, and fix it. This is what they said and promised, and we're going to. And I'm like, okay, cool. Do I have to? My mindset is that the only reason I worked so hard on the Levolution, a lot of us did, was to keep Ron up at that podium for as long as possible, espousing this philosophy of leave me aloneism. What is the proper role of government? How are we going? If you don't change the mind of the people, you're not going to have any support in opposition to, for or against CalExit. You're not going to have anybody out there beating, you know, the doors and doing whatever for, you know, Trump policy of leave me alone, whatever. You're not. They're not even going to know. Because when they first started taking over all the media, this is where Patrick Wood starts talking about technocracy and trilaterals over Washington in the late 70s and the consolidation of ownership of media and so on. It was there to get us to think a certain way. This is your opinion about this. This, if you're America, you think this about that. They were successful until the internet in the mid-90s just started. It was a cancer that's just been growing very rapidly to the point that, hell no, fake news. It's all fake news. Because we didn't say it. Fake news unless we say it's news, and it's fake news unless we say it. And then I don't think that's flushing with people either. They're just, no, these guys are not telling us the truth. They're trying, they, them, those, the ones that won't leave us alone. I mean, who are they? The ones that won't leave me alone. The one that wouldn't use the force. The one that's passing laws. The one that's making me. The one that's, you're a bad guy, terrorist, loving, whatever, if you don't agree with what we want to do. So my thing is the whole promise was the individual, that I get to do what I want as long as it's not bothering anybody. So that goes in things like building codes and what I do on my land and how many tomatoes I grow and whether I smoke weed or not or, you know, how many guns I have. I mean, all this stuff is all a product of opinion. You cannot beat public opinion. I don't give a crap what you do. If you have the people who don't want it, or don't like it, it ain't going to happen. I remember in Moon is a Harsh Mistress by Robert Heinlein, it was a novel about, like, they sent people to the moon like they did to Australia. You know, it was, you know, a penal colony. And then it declared its independence, kind of, you know, like did an Australia thing. In there, the government that they set up, you know, for lack of none, they had to wear it take three-quarters of their legislature to pass anything. Because if you can't get three-quarters of the people in support of something, then why do it, okay? And if you had one-third of the people wanted to repeal it after it had been enacted after a period of time, sure, like a year or something like that, if it took only one-third to repeal the whole thing. Because if you can't have a third of the people don't like it, it ain't going to work anyway. So that mindset, I'm thinking, yeah, wow, you know, if you got enough people, don't, even if it's not a majority, it won't work. And you're forcing it on a significant minority. So this is where I'm spending my time. I'm going to tell you what we're doing, and I have Davi come up and kind of describe the atmosphere in which this is going to operate. To be a pirate is what? I pirate software. I pirate broadcast. I have pirate radio. I pirate hack, you know, the energy. I pirate hack food. I'm pirating that. I'm a pirate. Pirate that. Arr. Now, that's one of the things that the Pirate Party, because they were technical and they were youth, their big thing was copyright laws, intellectual property, downloading movies, downloading books, downloading, sharing, doing. If you don't want me to know, the idea is this. If you don't want me to know it, you don't want me to share it, then don't tell me. Because as soon as you start putting these ideas and patents and gizmos and gadgets in my head, well, now humanity shares and it's kind of in the 100th monkey and we're all free. Well, no, you got to have a monopoly from the king. You got to have a granted copyright from the king. The king says who can and can't do something. This concept is not ingrained in that general opinion of Generation Next. They don't care. Right now, I'll tell you for everybody, in there, Donna got me a new TV, you know, for Christmas. Yay, it's a smart Samsung TV that, you know, before you do the setup, I'm sorry, the next step is you must give your DNA anal probe of whatever before you go to the next step and use your TV. Really? Okay. All right. Thanks for letting me know. So what happened, this has been happening for decades with computers. It wasn't until this last year, a year ago, August, like a year and a half, that I got Think Penguin, a Linux-based open-source hardware computer that interfaced with Linux open-source software. It's the first time that you could buy a computer that was totally made to run Linux. It came loaded, pushed a button, boom, it's on. Thing works great, pays. That needs to happen with all our electronics, our phones, our television, our computer interfaces, everything. And it's going that way. Decentralized internet is beating on the door. Here it comes. So what happens is I get what's called, it's a Google Q2 box. It's just a Raspberry Pi 3 running Android in a nice little box that you can get on Amazon for $100. I put it on the TV, and you can watch any video, any TV show, any movie, anything for free, streaming off some kid's computer in India. And it has apps. You go up, and a friend of mine set it up. He spent an hour and a half, he spent 100 hours learning it over the past year, an hour and a half setting mine up, and we have been watching any and everything, even if it's in the theater just open right now. It's out of date, wow. It's on here. Now, if you do it while they're in the theater, it's probably somebody holding a camcorder or something. I'll wait, you know. But it hits Redbox, boom, it's on the old free. You do away, Hulu, gone. Netflix, gone. Amazon, gone. The only reason I keep Amazon is because I get, you know, Prime, Amazon Prime, I get free delivery or something. Yeah. Okay?
What do you call it, Ernie?
Q2 box. It's a Matreon. I'll get you the box, show you. I mean, it's all over the place. It's called Kodi. K-O-D-I. Kodi is the app. Okay, you'll hear a lot about it. You type in Kodi on a search engine, it'll blow up all over the place.
Yep.
Now, it takes you a now, this is the problem. Somebody that would do, imagine this. You could have access to any file, pictures, images, video, albums, music, anything, if it is digitized, it's on the web, somewhere in this world. And this is how you access it. Now, who don't like that?
Right.
MPAA, this is TPP thing, all this is about copyright. They want that damn Chinese, you know, any negotiations is, you're right, you shouldn't be making DVD copies of whatever the heck. You go to Shenzhen, which is just across from Hong Kong on the mainland in China, there's what? 30, 40 million people? I mean, some ridiculous amount. You have five-story warehouses, and all they got is DVDs of the most recent release of everything. This is already happening. They don't know what to do. They want to have laws and prosecute and get people, and now they are going to do it digital. Now, this is where it gets illegal. If I am streaming it, it comes off like I'm just streaming from Amazon or Netflix. It's just streaming. It's just ones and zeros come on my TV, and they're got there and gone, there and gone, there and gone. It's not illegal. It's only when you download the file. If I was to download Passengers, if I was to download the recent movie of the Great Wall of, you know, Matt Damon going out and beating up monsters or something, okay? If I downloaded it and had it on there, then I'm in violation, or certainly they got evidence of it. If I'm streaming something, I just want to watch it or see it and I'm done, it's not illegal. Yet. Okay? So what do they have to do? They have to get into, they want to see what I'm down. Then you do what's virtual network, you know, privacy, you know, VPNs, they call them, and you go on and it anonymizes where you went, and they kind of track that maybe if they really care. Then you can have encrypted files that I can do and only I can open. I got the password. All of this is happening right, not later. So who knew this? The youth, the pirate party in Europe. This is their number one thing. They have two common denominators in all their political activity. One is accurate elections. I want to have them freaking, I vote on a piece of paper and it's doing their blockchain book kind of man. Now you're lying, sacks of snot. We're all the uber computer geeks and we know you're full of shit. Okay? So direct, accurate democracy is your thing, which I don't care about. Okay? But if you're going to do it, be accurate about it. So that'll be like another thing. The other thing is internet freedom, cyberspace freedom. You know, I get to do ones and zeros. That's all the internet is. Ones and zeros from somebody to somebody. That is it. Now, if it's encrypted and nobody else can open it, and only that part, the government's like, oh, hell no. How are we supposed to know what you guys are talking about? As if that was their right or something.
Right.
So this is where the battle is, but it's not just there. How do they have this kind of power and control and influence over us? It comes from being able to force us to use their currency. We don't have freedom of exchange. Legal tender laws, our government says, you know, putting ink on paper, and that's our monopoly. All right, you're not allowed. So we're going to talk about that. We have the energy, you know, just being able to. Spain taxes the sun. You think I'm kidding? They have, you know, Spain has gone, you know, you got a solar panel, that's $50. Just because you're getting photons, man. I saw you. Okay? Oh, you think that's crazy? Colorado, they just this last year, the governor of Colorado said, yes, you can collect rainwater. It was illegal.
Yeah.
But you know how much? 255-gallon barrels worth, and that's it. You're free. So this is the mindset. How do you change that? You go pirate. Now, this aircraft that you see there, that is a dirigible, a blimp, a Zeppelin. It's lighter than, that's why it's so big, it floats. Now, with the ducted fans, you'll see the ducted fans that have the propulsion and the lift and kind of go and do and, you know, whatever, and suck down and all that. They have rocket engines on them. Why? Because there are designs for these airships that they just go, and it's like weather balloon. They get up totally out of the atmosphere. They're freaking in space, just sitting there. Very little resistance of air. All you need to do is get thrust. Now, one of the depictions you'll see in the schematic that gives the different views and the profiles of the ship, you'll see on the side, those are rocket engines on the back. I'm going to Mars. When I say, man, I can leave, I mean leave, okay? Now, the other thing, on those ducted fans that turn, you'll see these are based on the new, what do they call them, Raptors, I think. God, I can't remember the name of the engine. They have the Merlin engine for the spaceship, for SpaceX and their ships. They have the other, I think it's the Raptor. And these new engines are smaller, they're thrusters that go on Dragon. When the spaceship, when the SpaceX has their Dragon capsules, goes to the space station, they don't come down by parachute. They can, you know, the emergency. They have thrusters, and they just land like Buck Rogers. The first stage of the rockets land like Buck Rogers. Now, that's why when you're in space, those ducted fans and propellers ain't going to do you anything because you don't have any atmosphere. That's why they have rocket thrusters on them so you can maneuver in space. Yeah. Then the main propulsion in the back. This is going to be the imagination. If you can get the imagination of Generation Next thinking this way, not borders or boundaries, because that's where this is going. But we're talking about like Cal Exit and all this kind of like, via con Dios, man, peace be upon thee, go. What's the threat? And to whom and why? Because we're thinking two-dimensionally. We're thinking Earth. We're thinking on ground. We're thinking, you know, we're only going to be able to grow food. If you look on a satellite at Arizona, that's why quartzite is in play and is such a big deal. If you look at the Colorado River, to the west of the Colorado River, big green valleys of all kinds, and that's where a lot of agriculture is. But what's happened, all the leaching of the minerals and the fertilizers and everything they put in, as that bleeds out in the delta, is just, you know, wasteland. Well, in Arizona, that same aquifer is on the other side, too. Arizona, quartzite, has tons of water. They're putting up all kinds of solar facilities up there, and Californians are starting to buy a bunch of land here in Arizona to do the same thing. Arizona is going to be agriculture big time. We have 30 to 40 years of surplus water in Arizona right now. I'm going, look, we're going to be fine. Let California go. We'd be rich. But, you know, what about the people in California? Do they want to come here? Do they want to stay there? Will it work? Allowing them to do it, that's the wrong question. It's why would they want to? and the people that want to, and who's supporting it. We've had Soros and friends trying to rule the planet. Right. Certainly Europe and America, and they're trying to get into Asia. You think Soros and these guys aren't heavy into Indonesia, Malaysia, and all that? Well, then what happens? They're losing so much. They lose Brexit. They're starting to lose the youth. They lose, you know, Ron Paul, the voluntarist, Lovolution, Trump, Phenom, whatever. And now they're all consolidated in California. L.A. on the corner of the homeless guy. It's going to get smaller up here. The battle is between the ears. That's what this is about. We're going to make cool and advocate pirating everything. Now, I'm going to have Davi come up, and we're going to talk about some of the tactical things that we're doing at the Renaissance Festival, launching some stuff, and on the 20th, and the idea behind how we're going to... You're going to see this on the internet. You're going to start seeing it happen. The Pirate Party, ArizonaPirateParty.com is already up. Now, on the tiles that we have, little graphics, that will be Pirate Broadcast Communication, Pirate Energy, Pirate. It has its own logo for each one of these categories. So each one of these categories, we already have an API, the feed from Freedom's Phoenix in these different categories that I just, you know, tagged. This is a good example of. Go straight on to the Arizona Pirate Party, so you have a constant news feed on different technology that's coming up. But it also has solutions. I'll give you an example. How are you going to do emergency services? I need 911. The ambulance needs to be a coming. I got somebody breaking into my house. I got a fire in my barn. I got, you know, what am I going to do? There are solutions, private solutions for all of this. The most forward-thinking one that's online now is called Cell 411. Now, Cell 411 was so successful to where when I push a button, my friends, neighbors, family come, and they know which button I push to bring a defibrillator, a gun, or a fire extinguisher. Oh, and if I need them to bring a gun, I'm being invaded and intruded, and they know what dog not to shoot. So this is going to be a totally different way of thinking, but that same software created 411 Connect. As you hear things like Uber, that I don't even need a car anymore. I push, I pay a few bucks, I go and I do it, and I get, and boom, and within 3 minutes, I see the car on my GPS, and he comes in right there, and there he is, and I see him, and I get in. But there's a server, and the man knows who called whom, where you went, and now Uber is tracking your phone. After you get out of the car, they know where you walked and where you went. What store you went into? I'm like, screw you. Hey, man, you totally agreed. Do you use this app? I totally agree. You agreed. Now, what happens is 411 Connect has the same services, and all the processing is just on your phone. It doesn't go to a server. So when I order somebody, they come on. I pay them in Bitcoin. They leave. Nobody knows anything about nothing. But what about the terrorists? That's what's always going to come in. If the man doesn't know everything, then people can do anything. It's called freedom. So that's why we're going to address all these concerns. How do we do that? Well, first you make it cool. Now you see the vest. One of the first things, the reason that vest thing is in there is because in Arizona, I am like, it is the stupidest thing when it's 6 months from now and it's 115-20 degrees and we're wearing suit jackets. I think that's the stupidest thing ever. Since I was a kid, how stupid is that? So can you have a nice attire that doesn't have the big sleeves? A vest, a dress vest. It's up, it's down, I got it's kind of cool, I make it out of a tweed, it's super mature, it's got a little leather accent, a little brass whatever, I got something. You know, forget it, Al, you're just causing problems, man. So what happens is we have this vest, and that will be the dress attire, which Davi will go in what we call it and why. Now you have tactical versions of it too. So this is a whole mindset, a culture that we're advocating that's going to come from young. Now, of course, you know, we'll have fun with it too, and who wants to play, and Ed looks like a pirate, so, you know, we'll get that taken care of. But so I just wanted you to know when it comes, and it's coming. I've had this conversation before. When the Lovolution started in the spring of 07, I had this exact kind of conversation telling my friends and people going, look, let me tell you what's going to happen. Right. Let me tell you what's coming. And I get to say, I was right. You're going to see in memes, you're going to see in support of people that, you know, are very popular on many social network platforms. Take, move, Terry, help move that over there and get a little Al's out.
Well, we got them.
Now we got fires and we're causing smoke.
Quick, call 911.
Yeah, call 411.
No mosquitoes.
Oh, there it goes. Now it's gone.
So you're going to start seeing a lot of these people that have hundreds of thousands of followers with millions and millions of hits. We had on the show yesterday, was it Melissa and Aaron Dykes that does TrueStream Media? They did a big feature on how YouTube is starting to shut down everything. Well, we knew they were doing this when they were doing it with 4409. 4409, you say, oh, he only had 300 hits. Right. We knew. He goes, she goes, I'll go on my site and it'll drop in views. I can't share it with the people that are even subscribers. Facebook, you got to pay to send it to people that are your friends. We had Libertarian Advisor Tim Pachoda out here. He's all, man, yeah, this Facebook thing, it's going good right up until it doesn't. Watch what happens. And he just knew he started, he exposed a million people right in the last months of Trump. It's going to end, and don't think they don't know, and all of a sudden not. There's going to be a big, giant shift to a new platform. Whatever that is, there's several that are coming. Yeah. But whatever that is, it's going, and people are going to go with it.
Yep.
Why? Because they don't have a choice. They're shutting it down to where fake news is all y'all, and we just got the truth, and damn it, that's the only one that you're going to be able to read. So Dave Hodges with the CommonSenseShow.com, it's going to be, and Freedom's Phoenix, keep in mind, we were like the beginning of the Levolution. You think they didn't target us from the beginning? I could see it happen, the DDoS attack, all the robustness of the back end of us preparing and getting ready for what's coming now, we've been doing for 11 years. 11 years getting ready for this because they thought the Levolution, all this other stuff, that was the battle. They thought that was it. They so don't freaking get it.
Right.
It is worldwide and it is a generation next. And they are already in mind of, hell no, we're not on your plantation. Yes, you are. No, we're not. Yes, you are. So it's all about proving that. Davi, go ahead and come on up. Davi's going to just give you some of the things that he's doing, the artwork that we're doing, the mindset, the philosophy. He may give you, you know, a little bit of the pirate code. I mean, just a lot of things of how this is going to structure itself, but we're not going to be in control of it. Everything that we do is to demonstrate how much we're not in control of it. That's the secret. How did the Love Revolution take off? Because nobody even knew I did it for a year. This is going to be organic. We're just going to help fan it. And a lot of the people that are very influential in doing this kind of stuff are already on board, including the founder of the Pirate Party. But mine's not a party, it's a party. Davi Barker.
Hey, how's it going, guys? So you guys may remember me. I was here some time ago talking about Bitcoin. And you probably heard me on Ernie's show and things like that. Sorry, I have a little bit of a sore throat, so just bear with me. I want to start, I want to address CalExit. I didn't know this was going to be a topic for today, but I'm here sort of as a Californian in exile, and so I wanted to address it a little bit. Back in 2003, during the Great Davis recall, that's when Governor Schwarzenegger sort of won that or whatever, that was sort of one of my first campaigns in politics, and I was behind candidate Robert Anton Wilson, who you might know. He's a kind of like libertarian adjacent satirist. And he founded a party called the Guns and Dope Party, which was, I don't think he had any intention of winning. I think it was just a piece of political satire. But the premise was that if the gun enthusiasts can tolerate our drugs, then the drug enthusiasts will tolerate their guns, and we can sort of get along. It was sort of like libertarian light in a way, right? But he was also running on a platform of California secession in 2003, which is what I was really excited about. And at the time, California secession was, like, they would put forward this idea that California was this really strong economy in the United States, and that we didn't need the federal government to, like, help us, that we were better off on our own because we were such a robust state or whatever. Well, that's not even remotely true anymore. Like California at this point, the union would be stronger without California. I want to put that out there, and I want to give you some examples as to why. The primary value that California has is Silicon Valley and Hollywood, and that's pretty much it. Now Hollywood, we're going to talk predictions of 2017. Georgia just changed a bunch of its tax incentives to try and seduce studios into Atlanta. Walking Dead is one of the most popular television show in the United States, and it films in Atlanta, Georgia. And so Georgia got this sort of bee in its bonnet. Like, how are we going to get people to come out here and set up their little independent studios and film and whatever? And so they changed their tax incentives, and they start sucking studios over from California. Marvel Studios, the largest grossing film studio in the United States. We're talking Guardians of the Galaxy 2 was just filmed in Atlanta, Georgia. So Marvel is leaving California. That's a Cal exit if I ever saw one. Marvel's leaving California for Georgia because California is such an awful tax state.
But China's buying Hollywood.
Silicon Valley is a fluke. It's a tech center because no reason at all. They're producing jobs that don't require geographical location. You can work in Silicon Valley from Hong Kong. Yeah. The idea that Silicon Valley is in California is an anachronism in and of itself. It is a self-defeating premise. So they're going to start to lose that economic. So the two strongest things California has going for it, they're going to lose. And they're going to lose because they're tax cattle. Because California doesn't understand economically the way businesses are run. So they're going to lose that. The other thing California is really big on is education. But here's the thing, they're not into honest information, they're into propaganda. California puts forward free education to its people as a premise because they want those people to go into Berkeley and to learn their sort of Marxist, communist, whatever propaganda so that they can go out and take over politically, right? So California, this is we're always talking about it as a culture thing. We talk, David, you were saying, and I appreciate everything you said. I'm excited to talk because you obviously have much more practical knowledge on this subject than me. But you were talking about it's not self-determination if it's a minority oppressing the majority. Well, California is in a state of the minority oppressing the majority, whether it stays or it goes, because it's a winner-take-all state, which means that San Francisco and Los Angeles and to some extent San Diego run the state. And they're not a majority of the people in the state. They're just a majority of the political power in the state. And the rest of the people just have to go along because it's such a gigantic state. If you want real self-determination in California, you need something more like Elon Musk's proposal to break the thing up into four different states. Maybe one of them goes, one of them stays, doesn't matter. But as long as they're going to be this gigantic winner-take-all apparatus, it is always going to be tyranny in California, whether it is in the union or not. So it doesn't really matter to me, and the reason for that is, it's in the mindset of Californians. This is something that I have seen between 2003 and now. Why I went from wanting California to secede so that I could escape with California to wanting California to secede so that I didn't have any more association with California is because there's a culture of tyranny in the left. Like, California is not mainline Democrat. California is radical leftist. And I know this having participated in the Tea Party. I know this having participated in the Occupy movement, that there are mainstream candidates who are trying to hold it to a mainstream left, but they have to appeal to this radical base or they're not going to get out the votes enough that they need to win. And that radical base is not like casually communist. They're like explicitly communist. They're like arguing whether or not Trotsky or Stalin was more correct. Like that is the level of the base level activism in California. I'll give you an example. I started an anti-war protest. This was I think in like 2005 or 2006. Now this is an organization that I started. Like I was part of the core group that got them together. I compiled the list of people that we were going to participate with, and we started getting together a rally that we were going to go out and pamphlet and do sort of an anti-war protest. Well, it came out in a casual conversation over coffee that I was not in favor of affirmative action. Okay? Now this has nothing to do with the subject of the rally. It has nothing to do with the war. It has nothing to do with anything to do with this organization. But the person who I said this to decried me as a racist, and emailed the entire list of activists that I compiled that I was a white supremacist and shouldn't be working. Okay, so this is the culture of California. It's petty tyranny in the minds of everybody, down to the last man. Probably not the last man. There's probably some decent people left there, but they're gonna leave. I'll tell you a perfect example. I went to a Yule party this year. Yule, I mean, technically Yule is before Christmas, but some people have Yule parties after Christmas because they want to burn their Christmas tree, right? Like you give Christmas to your family, and then you have a Yule party a week later to burn the Christmas tree and spend some time with your friends. It's a much more casual party. So, we're out in their backyard, and we're burning this Christmas tree over a fire. And everyone's talking about Arizona. Everyone at this party is talking about who has land in Arizona. I heard somebody just inherited some land in Arizona. What do you guys all think about moving to Arizona? Right? No. Like, these are people trying to get out. But then a spotlight from the sky sweeps over the backyard. Okay, they call these ghetto birds. There are helicopters that patrol the towns in California, and as soon as that happened, like, everyone's kind of like, their sphincter clamped up, and they're like, oh my God, get on your phone. Is today a spare the air day? Right? Spare the air day means you're not allowed to have a fire on your own property. That's what that means. And they just accept this. They accept that helicopters patrol their skies to make sure they don't burn things in their own backyard on particular days, which they have to check on the internet. So
we have no burn days here too.
So it's this culture of do you really? Yeah, right.
We do.
But do you have ghetto birds? Do you have helicopters? You probably do.
Yeah.
But my point is just culturally speaking, California is very accepting of this level of thinking. And if you were to cut them off, they would go and really explore that. That's what I think that they would do. If California was free to its own devices, they would really explore that tyrannical mindset, and they would probably lower the tyranny quotient of the rest of the states if they left. I'm not saying that I know whether or not the California people want that or whatever, but I like seeing things break apart. I like seeing jurisdictions made into smaller. So I just wanted to say that about Brexit.
Yeah.
Let's start with the Renaissance Fair. So, when I was young, I went to the Renaissance Fair at Casa de Fruta in California. It's like a big orchard property that they actually have like permanent infrastructure. Like they build up these things, and it used to be about using archival business building materials, and it was like a real fair. And they used to be very strict about. This is an Elizabethan period. We know the year. The year progresses forward every year. These are the materials that are appropriate to that period and whatever. And that meant that pirates were not appropriate at the Renaissance Fair. They were not period appropriate to the, like, 1350s or whatever that they were supposed to be, because pirates really aren't a thing until, like, the later, like, 1800s, right? Maybe 1700s. Well, the market won, okay? The sheer market demand for pirate merchandise from those types of craftsmen, the leather workers, the metal workers, and everything, they kind of, not forced, but they changed the fair. They changed the market of the fair. And they stopped saying, is it period appropriate? And they started saying, is it in the spirit of the fair? Right? And it is. The Renaissance Fair is not even technically Renaissance. It's the period that they were talking about was not Renaissance. So now, I remember the first Renaissance Fair that I went to in San Francisco, when they started having pirate stuff from the vendors, it exploded. And this was Pirates of the Caribbean was popular, and so the market wanted it, and so they said, okay, give the people what they want. So the question is, why pirates? Why are pirates popular? And I think to some extent we're talking about a metaphor that spans over many things. And when we talk about Scott Beezer's Quantum Vibe, if you guys ever read that comic strip, he talks about liberty to survive needs a frontier, because you need a place for free-thinking people to escape the strictures of the central authority. And so to some extent, when we're talking about piracy, we're talking about the high seas getting away from the empire, which means when you're talking about the Americas and you're talking about the frontiersmen, they're the liberty-minded people. Arizona is to some extent more liberty-minded than Republicans or conservatives of the East because it's a frontier state. So we're talking about the frontier as a metaphor. Piracy as the frontier of the sea, frontiersmen as the frontier of the land, and now Ernie's talking about the frontier of space as a fantasy, maybe not for long if we can count on Elon Musk and some others to get this to be a real thing. But I would say the actual frontier in the world today is technology itself. It's the internet is the high seas of the world because it's the place that you can go where the central authority can't find you if you're fast enough, if you're smart enough, if you're clever enough, which is what piracy is about. And you see this already happening in the culture that things like the Pirate Bay. Why did they call it the Pirate Bay? Right? Like, I don't know if you guys know, the Pirate Bay is a very large decentralized file sharing network that, like, they have a website, but, like, a number of times they've been taken down and then immediately it pops back up somewhere else because it's dispersed over multiple countries on multiple servers. So every time a government finds the server, they just transfer it somewhere else, right? So the Pirate Bay was just file sharing, but they called it the Pirate Bay because they understood that what they were doing was using technology to keep ahead of the armada, you know? You look at the Dread Pirate Roberts, right? This comes from Princess Bride, thank you. He's the hero of Princess Bride, and he's keeping ahead of the king or whatever. And he's the hero of that story, but why? And it's because he's anathema to the tyranny of the day. But then you look at the Silk Road. The Silk Road is this online website where people use Bitcoin to buy things with no moderator. So people list fake IDs and drugs and whatever. It's an honest-to-goodness, open, free marketplace, like piracy at the high seas. And the founder calls himself the Dread Pirate Roberts. Well, why does he do that? Because he understands that pirates are in opposition to the crown. Right, and we were talking about the distinction between a pirate and a privateer. Right, this is something that comes up in a lot of discussions, especially in California, with leftists when they talk about, oh, the scourge of private prisons. Right, well, private prisons are not private. If a private prison were private, I would be allowed to open the prison and throw Ernie in it and demand bail from all of you, or you wouldn't be allowed to speak. Maybe you guys wouldn't pay me. I don't know. But that's not a private thing. It's sort of like maybe in these circles we talk more about the Federal Reserve, and we talk about the Federal Reserve being private. Well, the Federal Reserve is not private. It's a private-public partnership, which is the very definition of fascism. So that's what a privateer is. A privateer is a sailor with a letter of marque or a commission or an article from the crown that says they can do something other sailors can't do. Right, it's a charter of corporation. This is literally where the concept of a corporation or a limited liability comes from, is that they're a privateer for the crown. So we're not talking about privatizing things. We're talking about piratizing things, okay? Like we don't want a public-private partnership. We don't want fascism in these industries. We want a vast, decentralized effort by anyone to do these things, to find out, you know, to use the metaphor, to go out into the seas and find the islands and find the coves where we can collaborate and have these open marketplaces and develop these new technologies and keep ahead of the armada. Like, innovation and the frontier is always going to stay ahead of the central authority because the central authority is almost by definition an anachronism in its own time. It is, they call it, what was it? One of those slang terms for an anchor was a mud slide? A mud hook. The state suffers from this phenomenon called the mud hook, which means that it's so entrenched in its own bureaucracy that it slows itself down, which means the criminals will always go faster because they're lighter weight, right? So it's just a matter of keeping ahead of them. And the way you do that is you cut weight, you cut overhead, you cut all of the bureaucracy and regulations and the things that don't matter. Here's why I say that I'm a Californian in exile, okay? So I'm a sixth generation Californian. My family has been there for six generations. I'm talking gold rushers and stuff, right? But the registration on my car expired January 1st of this year. And I tried. I, like, put in my due diligence to get this thing registered. But here's the thing. I drive a 2000 Toyota Camry that's totaled. There's no reason to spend any money on this car because I got T-boned by a gardening truck and it's totaled, okay? The engine is fine. The body is trash. But it runs, and that's all I need is a working engine. Now, to register in California, I've got to pass their emission standards. Oh. So I start going to try and get it to pass these emission standards. Now, every time I test it costs me $50, okay? And I fail it consistently, but they won't tell me why. You know why they won't tell me why? Because they're not allowed. They say that you have to go to a smog-only place because they want to prevent collusion between the guy who tests your car and the guy who repairs your car. They're looking out for me by making sure that the guy that repairs my car can't be the guy that tests my car. So I've got to go to another guy to test it again to figure out why it will fail. So that cost me $100 in labor to run all these diagnostics on the emission systems to figure out why it failed. Then I find out it's this part. It's a canister or something that captures carbon from the smoke. It's going to cost me $450 to repair. So here I am. I'm looking at $700, $800. Like, you throw in now I've got late fees from the registration, whatever. Oh, the mechanic tells me. You know what you do? You go into the DMV and you get a 30-day extension. They charge like $50 to get a 30-day extension. And then you tell them, here, just show them a failed smog certificate, and they'll give you 30 days to get the repair done. So I do that, right? I go into the DMV. I need a 30-day extension. I'm thinking I'm going to pay $50, I'm going to get an extension, and then I'm going to get out of California, right? And they say, oh, yeah, we can do that, but here's the thing. You've got to pay the registration before you can extend the deadline to pay the registration. So I have to pay the registration in full before I can get this 30-day extension, including late fees now. So I'm looking at like $250 in registration fees. And I say, well, I don't have that money. I need that money to do the repairs you're telling me to do. And they say, okay, here you go. Well, we've got this program, right? California's full of social programs. So we've got a financial incentive for emissions-related repairs. We can give you up to $1,000 on emission-related repairs. Here's the catch. You have to have a valid registration to apply. So, literally, they want me to spend more than the car is worth to register the car on a repair that has nothing to do with the performance of the car. Okay, now this is what I mean when I say that central authorities are an anachronism in their own time. This is the DMV, and this is true in Arizona, I'm sure, but I'm finding out a lot of places in Arizona don't have emission standards. That's why I'm here. It's a mud hook. They're dragging through their own bureaucracy, and this is the thing. Nobody understands this stuff. Nobody cares about this stuff. Everybody knows this stuff is broken. The employee and the customer, is it a customer, the mark? Everybody knows that this stuff is ridiculous, and nobody can change anything about it, but you just keep trudging on until it collapses. So the pirate is the one who says, I'm done with this. The pirate is the one who says, I can forge my own emission standards test. If you need me to have a piece of mail that says that I live somewhere to get a car registered, I can mail myself something. If you need me to, whatever, have a receipt, I can print a receipt. If, like, this is the thing. You have to just understand that none of this stuff matters. None of this bureaucracy matters. It's going to collapse under its own weight. And empires collapse. And when empires collapse, it's the fringes that survive. The people who are in Rome when Rome burns, they burn, okay? But the people who are in Gaul, the Gauls, when Rome burns, they're the ones who are like, we've been dependent on ourselves. We have our own code of conduct separate from Rome. So we've been talking about, given that piracy is already a thing in the culture and it's already popular, we're saying essentially that you just need to articulate why that is. Right? They say that libertarians aren't made, they're discovered. Right? It's the idea that these people already have a kind of subjective sense of why a pirate is popular, why a pirate in a movie is superior to the admiral of the Armada, or the Navy, because there's a subjective sense of freedom. There's this sense of keeping away from the oligarchies and the tyrannies of land. Right? So, the other thing that's popular, just to go back a little bit, is steampunk. This is taking off in Renaissance Fair, too, and it makes even less sense in Renaissance Fair, because steampunk is in the steam era. Like, it has to do with, like, steam engines and things like that, which is, even after piracy, it's into sort of the later colonial period. But steampunk is popular for the same reason, because that was the frontier. So we're saying, you got to take this message of history that the frontier is the source of history, and you've got to define it. You've got to tell these people what they already know in words that they can articulate, so that they can discover the principles they're already acting on, and explicitly organize around them. And so we're calling this the Pirate Code, and we've sort of begun, sort of redefining old pirate language, like Mudhook, and putting together sort of a article of conduct between pirates, if that makes sense. And it's the non-aggression principle. Like, you guys already all know this stuff, I'm sure. But we're saying that there needs to be a distinction between a pirate and a privateer. You don't get to say that privatizing a prison is a free market activity. Okay, that's not what it is. So let's talk fashion. This is the thing. We're talking about culture. So this is not a political manifesto. The Pirate Party is much more like the Guns and Dope Party, right? It's just about galvanizing people around a central idea. So it's about influencing culture. So if piracy is popular and we put together pirate fashion and we start selling products, or we start going, hey, we're going to pamphlet at Renaissance Fair this year, you get to put the pirate code in every little package, right? If a person says, man, that's a really schnazzy vest, we're calling it the parlay vest, because parlay means to, like, negotiate with enemies, right? you slip the pirate code in there. It's just a freebie. It's like a business card or an advertisement that comes with any other product, but you read it, and hopefully the person who is already out there, we already know these people are out there, like, there's already an Arizona Pirate Party on Facebook, hopefully those people read it, and they say, man, I agree with this stuff. Like, this is a way of codifying why this has appealed to me since the beginning. I'm discovering that I'm a pirate. I'm not making a pirate, right? So, there's some other, like, we could just go over language if you want, the parlay vest. We're working on a monkey jacket. Monkey was slang for a cannon or a small cannon, so we're thinking that a monkey jacket is, like, the thing that you'd use to conceal carry. Something like that. We're going to come up with some women's clothing, too. I'm concerned, especially in women's clothing, like, I've been at festivals and selling merchandise for, God, what, 10 years now, something like that. And women always complain to me that their clothing is impractical and there aren't enough pockets and all this sort of stuff. So I'm going to try and solve some of those problems. But here's what I'd like from you guys. It's like, 'cause this is what we're talking about. This is decentralized. I'm not here. I'm not a captain of this ship, all right? Like, I'm just a... whatever, I'm just another guy like you guys. So we're imagining that this stuff already exists, and we're just going to give it a kind of a framework to self-organize. So you guys have all got pens, and you've all got these things. I want to know from all of you, if you're interested, what's your favorite pirate lingo? Like, you've all probably seen Pirates of the Caribbean, you've probably been to the Disney ride, you've probably seen some of these movies or something. You got some, like, favorite language, you got, like, Scallywag, or you got, like, Davy Jones's Locker, or anything like that. I want to crowdsource this stuff. Like, how do you popularize this stuff in the culture that already exists? So, I guess I want to, you want to field some questions? Anyone have any questions about this stuff?
Well, go on about letters of mark and requirements.
Oh, right.
Talk about that.
So this is, we're devising these characters, right? So there's letters of mark, right? And this is like when a bounty is put on someone, they're a marked man, right? And so we're imagining that the crown is, they're not going to like this stuff. They're not going to like the idea that people are disappearing to the internet, off into the high seas of the dark web, where they can't find them. And so they're gonna mark people, right? In the same way that, like, Edward Snowden is a marked man, and Dread Pirate Roberts, Ross Ulbricht is a marked man. So we're getting explicit with it. We're calling our character Captain Mark, and he writes letters of mark, which are the letters that he writes to the various pirates, which are already out there, whether they know the pirate.
M-A-R-Q-U-E.
Yeah, it's M-A-R-Q-U-E.
Somebody sings a reprise, right?
Well, Reprisal, we call her the Fair Reprisal, is his quartermaster, his first mate. And so we've been sort of cartooning these characters out and developing their personalities. But they're not going to exist, right? Like, he's Captain Mark in part because he's the Mark. He's the Fall Guy, right? Like, if they start going after the Captain of the Pirates, well, there is no pirate captain, right? Like, Captain Mark is a fiction. So Letters of Mark is, again, like, it's like being a privateer. Like, they're the things that the Crown gives to a sailor to say, you can go hunt that man. And given, like, often those were, like, piracy is historically actual robbery. Like, it is a violation of the non-aggression principle. pirates are legitimate criminals most of the time. But in the common modern parlance, a pirate is an internet freedom activist. And this is what the European Pirate Party has been building upon. If you read their manifestos, it says the same thing. They want free information. They want uninterrupted, unintercepted internet access. They want declassified government secrets. Like, they're talking about freedom on the high seas of the dark web. That's what they want. And they're not criminals. They're statutory criminals. They're people who've stepped on stupid laws. They're not criminals with a capital C. They're not violators of people's human rights and things like that. The majority of the time. And if we get to codify this and we get to say, here's the pirate code, then we get to say, hey, you know what? If you attack a civilian, if you do something that is capital C criminal, you're not a pirate anymore. Like, we're seizing this term, and we're gonna define it as something that is more noble.
Okay, then get the fillet and then the cartoon.
Oh yeah, so then it's just propaganda. I'm essentially a propagandist. I'm a graphic designer. I've designed T-shirts and things for years, and so we're cartooning out Captain Mark and coming up with slogans and things like that that kind of come from pirate lingo. I think the favorite right now is belay the state. Right? Because belay, if you look at the original language, it means kind of two things. On a ship, it means to tie into place and prevent from moving. So you would, like, belay the sail means to, like, take it down and tie it in place. But you also belay orders, right? So this is sort of like sir, no sir, or to disobey, right? To and so there's this already popular culture, there's these obey giant memes, right?
Yeah.
And, why is that fantastically popular? I remember when the Obey line came out in like 2001, 2002, and it was just a knee-jerk reaction to what they saw as a growing police state in response to 2001 and the homogenization of the, you know, Home Security, National Security Department, that kind of thing. Yeah, and all of the
press ganged.
Press ganged is a great term. Yeah. And this obey giant stuff became popular, and then disobey became popular. And it's just, you know, being the Lego that the state steps on and hurts their foot, you know? Like, and so we were thinking we've got a cartoon of our Captain Mark that kind of looks like the obey giant in a way, but it kind of looks like a little bit of V for Vendetta. And he's got this, like, eye patch that has a hashtag on it, because, like, hashtags are kind of internet slang. And it says belay at the bottom instead of obey. And so it's like, it's there are all of these people who have, although they articulate it differently, a intuitive sense of freedom and liberty that we want to draw together with common memes and common characters and get them to understand that they have these common goals, that like the Raver and the Renaissance Fair guy and the gun show guy, and now the marijuana dispensary crowd, and like all of these people, they have a common enemy. Even though they are decentralized, they have a common enemy, and to get them to realize that. But this is not a political manifesto. Like, that's the thing. This is a culture thing. So they're going to articulate it differently. There are going to be people that don't like the words that Captain Mark puts out, but they'll probably still use them. Like, we want to inject this new vocabulary into internet speak. So, of course, Sierra was one of the terms we were talking about. Privateer, obviously. What are some of the other ones? If you guys want to, like, get into the weeds of the lingo that we're coming up with, I've got a whole thing on my laptop with about 50 terms. But the gist of it is there are these terms from pirate culture, and there are these terms from hacker culture that have very, because the metaphor of the frontier is consistent, you can move the language forward and use it again. Like, they probably, like, here's a good one, slush fund. Did you guys know that slush fund is pirate lingo? Get this. So, a cook on a pirate vessel, a guy who worked in the galley, when he was on land, it was sort of considered a privilege of his position to scrape all the fat and salt and gross gunk off the inside of the meat barrels and go into town and sell it, right? And that was called slush. And so he would have a slush fund. And what that slush fund was for was purchasing more luxury food items that maybe the captain wouldn't have budgeted, right? But the cook, being a sort of expert in his field, knows the things at each port to purchase. And he uses the slush fund to go and purchase these sort of nicer items, like fine rums or something, and bring them onto the vessel without being registered with the captain. But it was understood that if the captain was in a pinch, he could call on the slush fund. Right? This is where this term comes from. I was reading today that the cat is out of the bag is a reference to a cat of nine tails, the flogger, because it was a common punishment on a pirate ship to flog someone for a mutiny or something like that. And so when people would whisper about the captain or whatever, you might say to the person, man, the cat's already out of the bag. Meaning, like, the rumors are out that you're trying to mutiny, which means the captain's already got his flogger out. Right? That's where this phrase comes from. Pieces of eight? Okay, so...
we'll do the pieces of eight first.
So pieces of eight. We're trying to marry this to Bitcoin somehow. We haven't quite figured out the logistics of it yet. But when pirates would seize treasure from a royal vessel or whatever, when they would their plunder, they would have to disguise the source of that metal, right? Because you can't go into a Spanish port and sell the king's gold, right? It's just too obvious. So they would melt it down, and they would mint it themselves into pirate gold. And pirate gold was pieces of eight, which meant that it was struck in such a way that it could be broken up into smaller pieces to make change, right? It was struck with kind of like a pizza wedge, so that you could take one coin and break it into eight pieces and sort of distribute it out. So this was, in a sense, literally money laundering. They're obscuring the source of the funds. But also, it means that you can break the currency into smaller pieces, which makes it a more liquid currency. And this is born into sort of cryptocurrency. This is still a thing that, like, one of the advantages of a digital currency is that you can break it up into denominations infinitely smaller than a penny. so we're thinking maybe we would call an eighth of a Bitcoin was a piece of eight, or maybe we would try and, like, mint our own coin that was some measure of silver or something like that. But the point is that even discussions of currency are relevant to the pirate history and the pirate ethos, that these were not counterfeiters. These were people who were taking the king's gold and spending it in the people's port, like almost like Robin Hood. Not like steal from the rich, give to the poor Robin Hood, but steal from the tax collector and give to the taxed. Like, that's the real Robin Hood, you know?
In the pamphlet.
Right, so the pamphlet, this is our first shot, is we've got Renaissance Fair coming up next month. I'm going to be going, I'm working at the bakery, so I have like an employment position. I can be behind the scenes and sort of schmooze with people. We're going to be looking for craftsmen who have, like, we're looking for someone to make the vest and probably some sort of a blouse or a bodice or something.
Chainmail.
And the monkey jacket. So we're going to be looking for those artists and craftsmen to be sort of making some of this stuff. But also we're going to be distributing a pamphlet that is the pirate code on one side and a pirate vocabulary on the other side. And it's just like, this is part of the Renaissance Festival. We're going to be giving it to the attendees and saying, look, here's some lingo. You hear all these Renaissance people using all these strange words? Well, here's some of them. And part of the point of that is to encourage them to tweet and Facebook and social media this stuff using the hashtag with this language so that we can get a market signal from this fan base as to which of these terms is popular and why, and see how they're using it and why.
Explain to them how hashtagging works and why the iPad has it all.
Okay, so a hashtag is just, it's the pound key on your phone, right? But in a social media platform like Twitter or Facebook or something like that, it has the effect of creating an internal hyperlink. It's not like a hyperlink to somewhere outside of Facebook, but if you were to say, like, hashtag Captain Mark, and you post it on your Facebook, you say, Captain Mark is a scoundrel, and you put hashtag Captain Mark. If somebody sees that post on your Facebook wall and clicks on the hashtag, it's going to show them all of the posts from all of the users that have ever used the hashtag Captain Mark. So it's a way of, like, tracking a word instead of tracking a user, right? It's a way of seeing how this word is used. And people use it for all sorts of things. Like if you watch The Walking Dead, like down in the bottom right-hand corner, it'll say hashtag TWD, right? And that's because they want people, that The Walking Dead, TWD, they want people watching the show to give live commentary on Twitter and Facebook and hashtag The Walking Dead so that they can watch fan feedback in real time. That's what they're up to. They want fans to interact with each other, and they want to be able to watch what fans think of the episode in real time, because that's market information for them. But also for the user, and protesters use this and all kinds of stuff, it's a great way to, like, if you, let's say you invent a hashtag. We're just going to say, hashtag...
I grow food.
Sure.
And, I did.
Okay.
I created that hashtag.
But let's say you wanted to organize a protest or a political action of some kind. Like, I know, for example, in California and maybe in other places, it's actually illegal to distribute food. Like you have to have a license to, like, make a sandwich and give it to a person. So let's say you wanted to deliberately thwart that law, and you were going to say somewhere, I'm going to be out at this place, I grow food, hashtag, right? Well, now... other people interested in that action, who you didn't give any explicit orders to, they're not part of any list, they're not part of any group, there's no charter, there's no nothing. It gives other people the opportunity to be inspired by your action and participate in it directly by using your hashtag and saying, I'm part of that action, even though there's no communication, right? And then other people can follow that list. But I want to talk about social media too, because... we were talking, this is one of our predictions for 2017, is that YouTube or probably Twitter is going to be offended by something that Donald Trump tweets, and they're going to start trying to, like, block his account, right? Because Twitter does this. When people say offensive things, sometimes they try to make an example of them. And so our speculation is that Donald Trump will be incensed by this censorship, and he will launch his own Trump social media platform, and he will encourage all of his 45,000 million, whatever, it's millions of followers on Twitter, to leave, to twexit, right? to leave Twitter, right? Because Twitter is a centralized service. Now, Trump is probably not going to produce a decentralized social media account, but we might, right? And so I kind of want to think of these social media platforms as ports. Like, Twitter is a place in which the internet interfaces with the land, right? And it's a place where you might port, you might dock, and communicate with people on land, meaning in the system. But you can also leave. There are places where a person can encounter the ideas and the links and the hashtags and the concepts and the people who help them escape into a decentralized service, meaning to be at sea.
So these hashtags that you do, hashtag pirate energy, hashtag pirate this, that, everything, these hashtags, when you go online and you go, you know, do a search engine on hashtag pirate energy, boom, it goes in like hashtag I grow food.
One might already exist. If you went to Twitter now and you wrote hashtag I grow food, I'm willing to bet you will pull up thousands of tweets going back dozens of years. Three years. Okay.
3 years since the first time I posted. If you go all the way back to the very bottom, you'll see my post.
First. You use this hashtag
already. Hashtag first.
Okay, great. So this is a perfect example of what I'm talking about. You have launched this hashtag.
Yes.
Now, people who see your tweets, if they like what you're doing, they might also use that hashtag. They probably won't tell you. They're not trying to organize with you. But they will probably see how you're using the hashtag and then use it themselves if they're doing something similar. And I bet if you went and searched for it now, you'll see other users.
I searched for it, and I see Ed Vallejo up there, too, on Twitter.
Oh, yeah? So other people are already using it. We did this for Freedom's Phoenix, right? We just, what happens if you search for hashtag Freedom's Phoenix? And we found a post that, like, probably wasn't Ernie, it was probably Donna, but it was, like, a Facebook post from, like, 9 months ago where he had used hashtag Freedom's Phoenix. But we also found this group called Libertarian Objectivists, which neither of us had ever heard of, which were sharing Freedom's Phoenix posts and hashtagging Freedom Phoenix without telling Ernie at all, right? So this is like, it's a way in which you can maybe not directly communicate, but at least collaborate using these social
media platforms. Here's a really good example of how we used it. Here, let me do this, because this is a good point. This is how this is going to go. When we would go, we first started using the hashtag thing is when we started getting Instagram accounts. Instagram is just, I take a picture, I put it up. And we did it with, like, you know, the battery project or the aquaponics, or we do, you know, the aquadome and all that. And boom, it would explode, especially on the battery project thing. But then people wanted me doing it every day. Hey, man, what are you doing? Whoa, man, I got a life, you know, I got other stuff to do. Now, the thing is, you want to inspire it, but I already know how it's going to happen. When I go on these trips, I go to an Acapulco, or I go to Pork Fest, or like I'm next month I'm going to be going to Liberty Forum in New Hampshire. So when I go, I'll have different pictures. I'll take an Instagram, or I'll do post, and I'll go hashtag Freedom's Phoenix, hashtag Ernest Hancock, because I got my own thing, and hashtag Liberty Forum, or whatever else I want to do. Now, if I'm doing pirate stuff, I'll go hashtag Arizona Pirate Party, or something like that. Now, if I were to do a specific thing, like hashtag pirate food, or hashtag solar or energy or whatever, and you do that on a regular basis, what you're doing, what he's saying is that people will look at it and go, yeah, I know that, because they saw from the hashtag Ernest Hancock or Freedom's Phoenix or whatever the issue was, and they saw this other hashtag. So then they start following that hashtag. Then they share it with other people that think that's interesting. They start adding to it. When we hit this, and we go and it hits a Renaissance festival, each one of those glossary terms and pirate things and the code, what it means and then what how we want it to mean or whatever, hashtag pirate energy or something, well, they're going, yeah, I'm a pirate energy guy. I'm a pirate this. I pirate that. I'm pirate radio. We have local broadcasters now pirating our radio show out of Gilbert. I didn't even know this. You know, local Gilbert, KBFM, whatever, radio on the air. I start doing promos for around the country of all these people that are already doing pirate radio. So I'm going, all right, I want to support that. When you put that hashtag in, it's not a web page. It's not any effort. It's just putting hashtag whatever. And you take a picture of whatever you're doing, whatever you want to say, and it becomes a thing. When the revolution started, we didn't have QR codes, you know, those little square things that just take you anywhere, and we started making a big deal out of that later when that came. We didn't have the hashtag stuff. All of the contacts, all of the subscriptions, all of the people influential I have on the show, all of that, along with these tools, it's going to freaking explode. You watch with these tools.
I'll give you two great examples. This occurred to me just now. One is Kony 2012. Do you guys remember this phenomenon? This is like this is some African dictator that some like leftist group decided they wanted to make a big issue out of, and so they printed posters that were just like some graphic that was vaguely ominous, and it said hashtag Kony 2012, and they just put these posters everywhere. So these posters had no information on them; they just had this hashtag. And what they wanted the audience to do is get curious and go look, hashtag Kony 2012, what does this even mean? Now, the first post is their own video. So if you search for this hashtag anywhere, you're going to get their own video where they talk about the evils of this tyrant. But then you're also going to get all the, like, articles and blog posts and everything that anybody else who ever used that hashtag were talking about. So it was this, like, exponential growth of the popularity of this concept. And then suddenly this, like, dictator that nobody had ever really heard of or cared about or whatever was, like, a major talking point among the left, that they were, like, suddenly in favor of military intervention again. And I think it was a ploy just to get the left to be accepting of a war again.
We're going to invade Africa now.
But the other one is Occupy Wall Street. Occupy Wall Street began as a hashtag, and it was published by a magazine called Adbusters, which is like the sort of communist rag that sort of fights corporate advertising or whatever. I think it's Canadian. I don't know.
Brazil or something.
But they put in one of their magazines like this hashtag, and then like a description of the consensus process. Right? And it was just like a proposal. But then like people started going online and saying hashtag Occupy Wall Street and just hashtagging all of their stuff with it because they were trying to sort of build momentum behind this idea. And then it turns into actual action. What's hashtag J20?
Hashtag J20 is to disrupt the inauguration January 20th in Washington, D.C.
Oh, so this is an activist tag.
This is an activist hashtag.
Okay, so this is going to be... anti-Trump groups
yes.
that are planning some sort of protest or action, but they don't want to put it on a website that they think that this, the establishment can take down, they'll get on Twitter and they'll say, I'll be on the corner of da-da-da-da-da, hashtag J20.
Exactly.
And then anybody following J20 as a hashtag will see that as kind of like marching orders or something. Arab Spring used this for marching orders all over Egypt. It's a way of decentralizing...
You know they're in trouble and they want to outlaw hashtags.
Right. But that's the thing. Like, currently, most of these things are just embedded in the code. Like, it's part of the function of how Facebook and Twitter and social media works. This has become a sort of standard piece of the textual protocol of the way these websites function. So Twitter can say, we don't like this user, and take down this user. But Twitter can't currently, as far as I know, ban an entire hashtag. You know what I mean? Because that
can lower
hundreds
the
of thousands.
They have been.
They can lower it in the algorithm.
They can take it out down on the trending list. Yeah.
And actually, there's an alternative right now to Twitter. There was a guy named Andrew Torba who 4 months ago created something called Gab.ai.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a Twitter alternative because this kid got kicked off of Twitter and they're throttling. Like, let's say you have Hillary for prison. They could take that and throttle it. That way no one can see that. Or Hillary's health, and they could throttle it down.
Sure.
So it's called Gab, and it's hundreds and hundreds of thousands of people on it now. And it's but the problem is, at the Apple store said it promoted pornography, so they wouldn't let the app on there, even though I've been on it and
right.
I've never seen any pornography. But it's a free speech platform where they're not going to censor anybody. If you want to self-censor, saying, hey, I don't want to see anybody that posts this, then you can kind of free speech. You can do that. So this is already starting to happen.
It lasted 48 hours on Twitter,
right.
And then they stopped taking in applications because they got so overwhelmed after 100,000 people got in.
Yeah.
I've been on the waiting list for 3 weeks now, and they still haven't even sent me an email.
So this is what I'm really talking about when I say that a platform like YouTube or Facebook or Twitter, they're ports. But what we're trying to establish is coves. Right, a pirate cove is a port. It's fundamentally like a place where ships dock and trade, and they get their grog and their ale and all this stuff, and they sing their shanties and stuff. But it's not attached to the crown. Whereas, like, when a pirate ship lands at port, he understands that he's in the realm of the king, and there are ways in which he's got to be careful that he can get out of that port safely. You know what I mean? And so he might, like, you know, put on his airs and be a gentleman for a little while.
Wear a Starley jacket.
So YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, all of these things, these are compliant organizations. These are people who are going to hand your information over to the government if they ask. So these are not places for activists to go and set up shop. These are places for activists to go and capture audience. These are places for them to go and say, hey, you want to get out of this port? Because there's a cove right over there where we can do all of this stuff without the crowd. See what I mean?
So where's the modern-day Barbary Cove?
The internet. Well, most of what we're talking about is the internet, but I think that we could also organize things in meat space. So we're looking for things like the Silk Road. We're looking for things like Made Safe. We're looking for these fully decentralized people who have really embraced the idea of decentralizing these services.
Do you know about Scene.life?
No.
It's Facebook alternative.
Okay.
Approaching 200,000, from what I understand.
Scene.life.
S-E-E-N.life. It's out of Iceland.
This is really the thing, though. We're not designing these services. We're not providing these services. We are popularizing the reason for the demand for these services.
Exactly.
Right? And so we're essentially acting as a maven to say, like, look, I didn't invent Bitcoin, but if that's the problem you're having with currency... There's this cove over here called Bitcoin that solves a lot of those problems, right? And that might not be right for everyone, but we're going to essentially be, like, identifying them, figuring out why they work and what their shortcomings are, and I'm not really advertising them, but popularizing them, making people aware that these alternatives exist. And it's going to come to us, too. There's things like,
right.
like that's a perfect example. People are going to come out of this decentralized network and say to us, have you heard of this? This is a great example of what you're talking about. All we're doing is we're putting a vocabulary on it. We're putting a discussion around it so that these people who are interested in one kind of freedom and these people who are interested in another kind of freedom can collaborate and realize hey, you know, you guys could both profit immensely if you collaborated. Like Rennie's, for example. I'm always going to come back to Renfair because this is next month and it's on my brain. But they're tax cheats. You know, they don't want to. They're a cash economy. They don't want to declare all the stuff that they make at this fair to the IRS. Like they might not be philosophically against taxes, but they, as a merchant, understand that. So if we can say to a person who's currently moving from fair to fair, trying to sell his chainmail, hey, you know, there's a whole audience of people that also want chainmail. They're not like fantasy enthusiasts. They're hackers. But they like your style, and they're over here at the Silk Road or the Bazaar or whatever. You start connecting. You start making these connections for people.
Brian's going to start passing. They're just passed a hat around, you know, for donations to Donna because she can go get her hair done or something.
And then once you get people connected because of one shared interest, independent of us, They'll begin collaborating and communicating and discussing, and they're going to take this ball and run with it. I don't anticipate being at the forefront of this ball. You know what I mean? I don't even want to be. I'm sort of saying, like, here's a ball that's already rolling. Let's kind of push it a little bit because I like where it's going.
Okay. Keith, questions? All right, here. Yeah. Keith, go ahead and take the microphone.
Test.
There you go. Just take it back there, and you can be the Bill Donahue. And you hold the microphone, you never hand it to anybody.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because they all freaking go off in the god knee and just go, man, you're done.
Yeah, oh, really? Communist technique. I have three thoughts on this.
Oh!
I can't wait to that speaker.
Oh, Jesus.
Yeah.
Gotta go to the microphone.
Yes, and get away from the speaker. Anyway, on the pirate thing, the original American Revolution was kind of a pirate thing.
Sure.
But it turned into the thing that created the Civil War. So I wonder what mechanisms we put in place to keep the pirate thing from going to its dark side, which it has in history, when the economy gets rougher or whatever. People using pirate thinking to go ahead and take other people's stuff and use the non-aggression principle.
Sure. So there's already an ethos in the hacker community. They call it black hat hacking or white hat hacking, right? So, like, white hat hacking is good guys. It's the same as frontier language, right? That's where black hat and white hat comes from. So black hat hacking would be hacking for personal gain or whatever. Like you could, but that's an ethos that's enforced. It's not even really enforced. It's just sort of like you don't get to be the cool guy if you're the bad guy. You know.
See, the thing is, you're thinking that, you know, well, somebody's going to be a pirate. They're going to use this. This community to go do evil and the pirate thing. Because that's why I was saying I wore 4409s, because he was like confronting pirates.
Yes.
What he meant was confronting privateers.
Yes.
We have to define what it really means. Privateers are the sanction of the king to go out and pirate and steal from somebody. No, I can, because I got, you know, my king says I can, you know? So this is, it's a redefining of it. That's why we have the pirate code. And this pirate code, this terminology is already starting to take over around the world. We're just helping define it even more. And Rick Falconwing, it's Falcon Convair or whatever, but it means Falconwing. Rick Falconwing that founded the... See you guys later. When Falconwing actually did the pirate party in Sweden, and it went quickly to Germany and Austria and started taking over, he told me on the air just the day before yesterday, he goes, Ernie, if I'd known... You know, I would have called it voluntarist. You know, I would already have been down that this was what I was trying to do. And his book, you know, that he wrote called Something Wise, whatever it is, he has a book that defines all this. So when you say, yeah, they're going to go bad, well, then they're not pirate according to our definition. You are, it's a non-aggression. Yeah, go ahead, read it. You know, this doesn't take that long. After he reads this, then bitch, okay?
Well, I'm not bitching. I'm just bringing up ideas right now. Oh, wow, it's early.
So this is a rough draft, right? And I just posted this on Facebook to, like, solicit feedback from people. And in full disclosure, I'm taking these five planks from the Shire Society Declaration from this group in New Hampshire. And the Shire Society Declaration took these five planks and adjusted them a little bit from L. Neil Smith's Covenant of Unanimous Consent. So this is... These are five concepts that have sort of been floating around. I'm just rewording them kind of like pirates, right? And there's a little bit of a preamble. So it says, a pirate's life is dedicated to the evolution of an autonomous society which respects individuals' control of their life, liberty, and property. History has shown that no central authority, whether royal or parliamentary, can be trusted to secure these rights, for the power vested in such authority derives from the violation of these rights. So we take this responsibility upon ourselves and establish certain articles defining the conduct among pirates. First, a pirate is the sole proprietor of their own booty, and obliged of nothing except those duties created by consent. Second, no pirate nor crew, however chartered, may initiate force or fraud against any other pirate. Third, a pirate may, without permit or rank, defend themselves against the initiation of force or fraud from any pirate, or anyone. I should change that. Fourth, a pirate may not be pressed into service, and claims of obligation to which any party did not consent are invalid. Fifth, rights are not collective or additive, and no captain nor crew can possess rights exceeding those of an individual pirate. And that's it. Like, that's essentially, like, you're an individual, you have the rights of your life, liberty, and property, you can't violate the rights of life, liberty, and property of others, or you're not a pirate by this definition. And I know that people are going to continue using pirate as common parlance for other things, and I know that there are going to be people who subscribe to these ideals but don't like the pirate aesthetic, but this is just an effort to communicate these principles in a way that this growing fan base can read and hopefully it speaks to them, right? So the conclusion here, wait, hang on. So may these words quake in the heart of every tyrant who has trodden on mankind long enough, and if your heart bears witness to the truth of it, then shake the shackles of the persecuted world and declare a pirate's life for me, right? So this is, I guess, our main distinction between the Shire Society and the Covenant of Non-Consent, is that, or unanimous consent, is that both of those groups are asking people to sign a document and join an organization. And we're saying, don't do that. This is not an organization. You just declare it. You say, I'm a pirate, and nobody gets to say that you're not. We're not. There's no list. There's no registry. There's no nothing. You just say, a pirate's life for me. And hopefully that catches on. Hopefully this leads to a sort of decentralized effort of people liking and spreading these ideas.
Okay, now this is why this is important. Anyone that's listened to my show, every now and then you hear me say, you know, I come back from a break and I go, declare your independence. It's really easy. This is how you do it. You go, I declare my independence. See how easy it was? No government form. See, this whole idea that I need to declare my independence, I signed here and we vote and go, man, either you're independent or you're not. I declare my independence, and I don't need a freaking form to do it. I'm just done. All these different, you know, L. Neil Smith and Davi went at it because what happened when the Shire Society honored L. Neil Smith by taking his Document of Unanimous Consent or whatever declaration and making it the Shire Society, he was all pissed off, pounding the table and everything because they didn't give him credit.
They didn't give him money.
They didn't give him money. Well, yeah, he wanted to, you know, buy my copyrighted whatever because he's in that mindset. And that just didn't go well with the voluntarist community. L. Neil, you're not going to win this one. Don't do that. Well, the Shire Society, of course, they want a geographical area, the Shire. They're doing this kind of going, you know, these are good ideas. I grew up, you know, my activist career 20 years ago on L. Neil Smith kind of mindset. We're good friends. But he still is this, you know, Ron Paul, G. Edward Griffin, and all that. We got to get back to the Constitution. We got to have some structure. We got to come together. Nationalism, patriotism, you know, all this Dave Hodges stuff. But that is a significant port that we can interface with. We're going to go visit Dave Hodges a lot. We're like, hello, the pirates come and say hey to Dave, you know. But what are we doing? We're introducing people to the concept of you don't need a permission slip. That's the whole point. So what's going to happen? And one of the reasons why I called it the Arizona Pirate Party as opposed to parlance or group or pirate kiss my buttish or whatever it was, the reason I said party is I go, one, it's kind of be a party, but it still strikes fear into the politicians. Why? Because they're looking for, you know, something that's going to threaten them. They're going to come after them. You're going to come up with some initiative or thing or whatever. So what's going to happen? just what always happens. The reason I ran against John McCain in 04 is because he was in the Chicago Tribune. He's maverick. Remember that? He's a maverick. Yeah. He's running for president in 04, you know, I mean, in 08. He knew he was going to go. He's the maverick, right? Yeah. So what did he say? Oh, yeah, I'm a libertarian senator from, you know, representing in Congress. I'm libertarian. I'm kind of libertarian, Arizona libertarian. And I'm like, oh, hell no. Okay, you want to see how libertarian you are? Then I went on the ballot run against John McCain. Let's see who's libertarian. That was the reason for that. So what's going to happen with this pirate thing? The first election that comes up in 17 is in August, the city of Phoenix. Petition signatures to run for city council is 200 is all you need to be on the ballot. And it's not a partisan race. You can have initiatives on that take so many thousand. You got your mayor. You got races going on here in 17 in August. So this becomes a thing. What's going to happen? You're going to have politics. Yeah, I'm kind of pirate on that. I'm a pirate. I'm a pirate. Look at me. I wear an eye patch pirate. There's going to be some politicians who are going to tell you how pirate they are. Are they? Yeah. You go by his code.
They're a privateer.
Yeah, they're no. You're a privateer. You're going to get nailed to privateer. Oh, I'm a privatized prison. Well, then you're a privateer. The definition of all this stuff gets learnified. All right? So the people understand, yes, they're going to say pirate. Why? Because it's a bucket of votes. Because it's a popular meme. Because they think they're going to jump in front of it. That's why all the politicians here, the Republicans, yeah, Ernie, you and your people. Man, you guys don't get it. There is nobody's people. They just keep thinking this revolution like it's consolidated, it's a Freedom's Phoenix thing. But as time has gone on, they're starting to see it's just a movement, it's a mood, it's an opinion. So pirating, they are going to do exactly what you're talking about. They're going to try and hijack pirate. Yeah, I'm pirate, I'm pirate. I say R a lot. It's going to be right before the election. Every politician on the planet is going to be on September 19th. I talk like a pirate day. Arizona. I guarantee it. So when they do, how do you defend against that? Hey, man, don't you say and did and kind of, you're not a pirate. You're a privateer, you scumbag piece of crap. Amen. I anticipate them doing that. I need them to do that. That's why we have to define it now.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions?
I have one more point. If you're going to be a pirate, probably some portion of your life needs to be off the electronic grid. Or you're not going to be able to get into port safely. They'll have you preempted.
Yeah, you should write something. There will be a category. Sure.
Yeah, okay.
We'll do anarchist category.
That certainly already exists.
Yeah.
And I mean, you can start popularizing alternative energy. I mean, we've been talking about pirate energy, right? So let's say, for example, you're living in one of these places that wants to tax sunlight. Right. Well, that means that if you're like, well, I'm going to get myself a solar panel and I'm going to keep it off the books, I'm not going to declare the energy, then that's pirate energy. Yeah,
I'll talk
right?
about the bones, or the bones.
Oh, yeah, we were talking about bones. So one of the things I do is I run shinybadges.com where I make these like lapel pins, right? And so we're talking about doing a line of like a skull as sort of the primary pin, and then like bones as sort of secondary pins, and using them almost like rank bars, but more like merit badges, so that they'd be colored to connote particular activities, right? So maybe, we haven't defined this yet, but let's say, for example, pirate energy was yellow, right? And so if you see a person with like the pirate skull with the yellow bone, you're like, that's a guy who's into solar or wind power, or he's into some kind of pirate energy. And you as a person who knows this language can just see that pin and be like, I know what yellow bones are about. But, like, the tax collector might not.
Yeah. Earn your bones.
Earn your bones.
You're getting, this is the paraphernalia that we'll be having that you do. And you can define what that means. Am I able to power a single electronic device off the grid? Do I have enough solar? Did I go get a Goal Zero, whatever the heck, to put on my backpack and charge my phone? Boom, you win. You earned your bones. So what about shelter? The domes. Pirate dome. I mean, you know, we're doing all of this stuff is coming online, and it defines it. So we're going to have a lot of fun. And this is going to be in what? Separating yourself up here from the control. That's What's so dangerous today than those? When you just have the opinion and you add that with something that can actually be done. Even emergency services like with cell 411, transportation, Uber, cell 411, Lyft, blah, blah, blah. You have all of these, and we set the highest standard for decentralization if you're not on the grid. And having a webpage, ArizonaPirateParty.com, is, you know, too much centralization there. That's why we're going to be using a lot of hashtagging. But it's also attire. That's why we mentioned steampunk. Steampunk already has, it's kind of a pirate look anyway. If you go steampunk clothes on an image search, it'll blow up all over the place. And man, I mean the women's clothes are babish, man. They got something going on. So I'm going, yeah. So this has a total already in place army just waiting to have this defined. And where are we going to start it off? At the Renaissance Festival. It's already going to happen. And we're sharing this with you. I've been working on this for what? Almost a couple of months now. And I already had in my head what was going to happen. So who do we put on the team? Athena, that does a lot of the covers and the art that you saw of our covers, she did the kind of the Pirate Cove. She's kind of working, I said, and she and I went back and forth on that. She did the first ship that you see, just kind of the outline of kind of the concept and the size. It's like a freaking flying building, okay? So we got that. But I always had Davi, Derek, Majek, which is a graphic artist and pirate guy in Poland, you know, that we work with, and Scott Beezer. Scott Beezer has been a great graphic artist I've known for a couple of decades, and early on he did a lot of our covers and so on. I wanted him for the ship because he did the different profiles that you saw in one of those. Well, it looks from the top, the side, and all that. Because other categories and pages that you go on on the Pirate Party, not just the main page, you will see different orientations of that ship in space, flying, landing, taking off, doing it, because we needed these different profiles. Why? So people could understand, I don't need my flying car anymore. I need my flying house, my flying business, my flying car that has my flying car, fighter, whatever in it. So this whole mindset concept, because it's coming, it's a lot closer than you guys think. They are going to launch, one of the predictions is they're going to be sending a supply ship for manned missions to Mars this year. Wow. This stuff is happening now. And the big space cities, they're going, when they got reusable spacecraft, and how fast can we pump up, you know, some, you know, graphene carbon nanotube rod of light and strong and conductive and whatever and spaceship and we're done? So we're building it up here now to demonstrate this because it's already coming. It's not a prediction. It's just, it's on the board, man. It's happening. Rock and roll. So this is what I wanted you guys to experience, and I'm glad you guys came here, because the Breakfast Club, I remember in the 90s, if I didn't hear it at the Breakfast Club, certainly before the internet, you didn't know it was happening. And you would get, those of you that went to the Breakfast Club back in the 90s and so on, you were years ahead, if certainly months ahead of anybody else understanding what was coming. And these young guys back here, come on, how far off am I on this? Is this some coolness factor or what?
Yes.
Come on, you know. And you're going to ASU next year, right?
Yes.
You just graduated high school, freshman at ASU.
I graduated GCC.
Give the mic.
Okay, so you graduated GCC. Yeah, give the mic. Tell me what you're going to do. Are you in, man? What are you in? What are you doing?
Well, I just graduated from GCC. Now I'm going to ASU. I'm going for my bachelor's in political science, and I'm considering teaching it as well. But.
And this would be boring to your students?
Well, I would try to make it fun and interactive for them, you know?
Yeah, well, let me tell you how you do that. You talk about pirate stuff.
Teach them what they aren't taught in school, right?
Right.
So you can, I just wanted you guys, you're seeing this, and a lot of times, imagine, if I was doing the same thing 10 years ago for the Lovolution, you'd be going, when you're kind of pie in the sky, I'm kind of nerdy, and you're just being whatever. You're getting the same talk that I gave in February of 07, explaining what was going to happen with the Lovolution, and it was this. For same reasons, it was that the interactivity on the internet, the ability to communicate in real time, us being able to find out good things that we'd learned 10 years before in the 90s, you know, doing our political activism, Libertarian Party, and so on. Now, it's again, because the difference with The pirate thing is that the Lovolution was still kind of Arizona and U.S. oriented. This is not. It's generation oriented, and it's festival, right? And that's one reason why they have one of the groups called Language of Liberty that goes to these young people around Europe. And they call it Language of Liberty because everything's done in English. Why? Because the second language of anybody under 30 in Europe, they all speak English. That's what they're taught. They're telling you, this is, man, we are lucky, 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 lucky. And who's trying to invade that? China. China is doing everything they can to take over social controls, opinion. That's why China is buying up all the studios in Hollywood. But while they're doing going all communist and Jerry Brown, we hear from Davi. Movie industry is moving to Arizona and Atlanta and wherever the hell. It's free market dominates everything. They're so far behind, they can't keep up. We just need to make sure we got the opinion there waiting on them. That's what we're working on. Any other questions?
Where's the bathroom? Fine.
Yeah, just go in. It's to the left.
Okay.
There.
Make sure we get that on tape.
Okay. I just have a kind of a point and a request that you think about a couple of things. The point I have is that I see a whole lot of semantic linguistic problems, cultural problems with the word piracy or the idea of piracy movement. If it's undefined and left just floating around, and that's the way most people are going to kind of connect with that concept or some of these images. I think you got to kind of tune in and get really focused on specifically what you want to impart with that meme.
Decentralization of everything.
Well, okay, that's part of it.
That is it.
No. There's
see, when you do this, you just piss me off. Because
No.
Everybody answers always yes. You can do whatever you want. You can't stop me from doing whatever I want. That's the point.
All right, and the point is that I'm trying to give you an idea that's even more fundamental to this.
Waiting on you now.
All right? So we're really talking about the whole point of self-determination. The piracy label comes in as a meme that communicates that I am taking back from what everybody else thinks the state has, or the king has, or the globalists have, or the New World Order has, or the EU has. No, you ain't got that. I got it. And I'm taking it. If I have to, I'll take it.
See, this is the one thing
that's where the piracy comes in.
This is the one thing that is allowed in this and encouraged. The hashtagging of anything, anybody can say whatever they want. That's why it's important early on for us to have this lingo, this definition, this glossary, this definition. Because then it's going to have letters of mark.
Yep.
You know, Mark's going to be, who's Mark? You know, I am the Dread Pirate Roberts. Well, I mean, you know, it was one guy or a few guys or whatever. Letters of mark, it's going to have to comport to the whatever this definition is over here that we popularize. Because somebody, there's going to be trolls. There's going to be people go, no, letters of mark, we, you know, lop the heads off of all congressmen or whatever. Okay? Well, does that comply with the code? Not really. So it's probably not a letter of mark. Not that anyone pay attention to. But there will be people that try to co-opt this. That's the point. They're going to try. They want to. So anything you go, well, you need to say this or it needs to be that. It's only that if it is supported and popularized by people that encourage or share or add on to that. Nobody's going to be able to say no. It's always yes. When I did the Lovolution, they go, oh, you should this and you can't that. And you got to get a permit, put these things on Chainlink. And I'm going, they're like, well, you think a yes? Before they even say it's yes, the answer is always yes. It's just whether somebody else will support it. It's whether it's popularized. So from our experiences, we're going to try and be very clear of what our definition of pirate is. And the more we got into it, we could see the pirates were the privateers that turned on their own master. You had the king would go, yes, I give you leave to go and pillage all the Spanish galleons and go get all their gold and give it to me. You get a cut. Peace out. And we won't shoot at you. You don't shoot at us. And at some point, the king will be, you know, a butthead, or they'll do something wrong or wrong them or whatever. You know what? You're on our list now. I'm a pirate. I'm against you. I'm not sanctioned by anyone. So we get to define this. Anybody that tries to define it, they're going to have to come up against the voluntarist movement of a voluntary that's already defined. And when we do it at these different festivals and so on, that's going to be interesting. And in fact, Michael, you need people to challenge it. Controversy creates commitment. Controversy helps define things. You're going to have the battle. You think I haven't seen this battle between, you know, libertarians versus the status? You know, you haven't seen, you know, the anarchists versus the libertarians, the voluntarists versus the anarchists. I mean, you know, I've seen this progression, and it always gets more and more defined and be way over here. I need the conversation. It's essential for this to grow. So somebody's going to, when you say, you know, no, you need it, man, you already lost before you even started. You know, if you say, I think, or I believe, or I want to define, and if you get enough people doing that, you win it. That's how it's good. There is no central plan for freedom. That's the point. So we're going to define these, and we'll just have some fun with it. You know, one of the other things is songs. You know, and Kai over here, a lot of people you may not know, her father is Ben Stone. Wrote some great books. He was the Bad Quaker, okay, a podcast that he had. That's his daughter, you know, and she's, and Davi, you know, going to have the contacts with the Renaissance Festival and so on. They're experiencing that. So I'm just going, yes, it's already starting because serendipity is working. Well, she came up with the idea, don't you have pirate songs? I'm like, oh, hell yeah.
Sea shanties.
Yeah, sea shanties. What do you do with the tyrannical status? What do you do with it? You see my point?
Yeah.
I mean, it's just going to go on and on and on. Any other questions? Comments? All right. This was good.
What do you do with
a
tax collector?
What do you do with a tax collector? See, I'm just, you know, we're going to have some fun with this. And there's a whole bunch of these little shanties that go in and people wearing R. And we had, Ed brought a 1850s boarding cutlass. You know, I thought that was awesome. You know, at the Christmas party, you know, these. So this is the conversation I remember. It's a 10-year anniversary for me for January of last, you know, January, February of 07. So this is 10 years ago. I had this same conversation with a group of some activists, and it was the dozen of us, and Keith was there. The first sign that ever got painted, the Ron Paul Lovolution, the first one. Were you there, Les? Yeah, I think so. The first sign was a 12-year-old kid. He's what, 12, 10, the kid, young man? We let him make the first sign. A 12-year-old kid did the first sign. And then it took off. And you're getting it right now. It's going to happen. And anything you want to do, the answer's yes. So when you come up with what you need to do, no, it's what you need to do. Don't tell me what I'm already doing, what I'm doing. It's creating a framework and a mechanism by which you get to do whatever the hell you want. But we defined the pirate code, and it's voluntarism. Peace.
Woo-hoo! All right. Could you hand me that? So now you guys.
Yeah.